With the damn music. Okay, shalom, everybody, shalom. God damn it, this is your old pal, Rabbi Sol Solomon, founder, spiritual leader of Temple Sons of Bitches in Great Neck, New York. And I am thrilled and delighted to be talking with an actor, a comedian, and a monologist? I have to look in the Talmud for that. But oh my goodness, let me tell you a little bit about the person that is joining us at this very moment, who has to also unmute his microphone there. But his name is Robert Dubac. His previous solo shows in New York included The Male Intellect and Oxymoron. He was, this is very interesting. He co-starred in a show called Real Geezers of Beverly Hills Adjacent. I love the name of that. We have to ask about that. He was a regular years ago on the soap opera called Loving. I was on a soap opera called Stupping. I'll tell you about it.
That's with a solid G too, right?
The
G. Loving.
Yeah.
Yes.
Damn it.
I'm going to put on my Jewish accent for you for this whole time, okay? All right.
Are you one of the tribe?
I'm not in the tribe. I'm tribe adjacent.
I like that adjacent thing. Dana Carvey has raved about this man. Quote, if funny was a religion, this guy is a miracle. I've been told I'm kind of a tragedy about that. But I am Rabbi Sol. This is Robert Dubac. So shalom. And is it Dubac or Dubac? Tell us.
It's Dubac, like in a few minutes.
Really? It is Dubac. Yeah. That's why we're calling the show Back At Ya. Get it? Back At Ya.
So okay. Dubac At Ya.
Back At Ya. Shalom to you. How you doing?
I'm good. Thanks. We're just getting started. I'm here in New York, waving off the heat. And we're getting ready to do the show starting Thursday.
Now, are you based in L.A. because you did a lot of television work, or where's your home?
My home used to be in Colorado.
That's right, in Telluride, yes?
Correct. Far up 9,000 feet away from everybody, because I thought as the world was crumbling down, I wanted to have a good view of it from up high.
So why the hell did you leave Colorado, of all places? Everybody goes to Colorado. You don't leave it.
I had to finance this show in New York City, so we had to sell the house.
Okay. God, man, never put your own money in a show. You've seen the producers.
I know, but
I'm
not a Jew, so I don't know how to take that advice.
But you have a producer, I assume, or maybe you're renting the Soho Playhouse from Bernie Coley. Right. Yeah, mm-hmm.
We're there.
But I assume you have people behind you who are backing in because you've done other shows.
Yes, I do. Of course, we're being funny here, or trying to, aren't we?
You're hilarious.
All of a sudden, everything's taken serious, right?
let's stay on the comical hilarity level.
Okay.
So how long ago was it when you first brought the Male Intellect and Oxymoron to New York? Because that's the first time people really heard of you here.
Well, yes and no. I really did the Male Intellect. I started that about 20 years ago, and it never started in New York. It ended up in New York after going all over the country and all over the world. It's still actually being played all over the world in different languages. In fact, it was done in Tel Aviv in Hebrew.
Yes! What is the word for
Because we know the tribe has to understand what Male Intellect an Oxymoron means. So it was there. It did very well. So it does well all around because that's a show about relationships, about men trying to understand women, women trying to understand men, and basically men growing up and not being, you know, the pre-Me Too movement. So that then when I brought it to New York, it was back in 2015, 2014. It was really just in tandem with the new show that I'm doing now, which was a workshop. So basically, I had to get fans who saw that show. And then kind of, you know, it's just bait and switch. Yeah, get them to let me workshop the new show, which is the Book of Moron,
right?
Not the Book of Mormon. I mean, religion seems to have a theme everywhere here, doesn't it? Huh?
Well, wouldn't it be great if you get all these people who were thinking, oh, we're going to go see the Lin-Manuel, the musical from the South Park guys, and they suddenly find themselves on Van Damme Street, as I like to call it, Van Damme Street. Yes.
Well, look, if they think they're going to see the Book of Mormon for $25-$40 on Van Damme Street, then the Book of Moron is titled specifically for them. Yes,
I get this. So what is the difference thematically between the Male Intellect and the Book of Moron?
Well, the Male Intellect is basically all about, like I said, about relationships. And it's about a one man trying to grow up. The story was basically when I was in my 30s, I started writing. It was after I did Loving. I was on the soap opera, which is you're completely bombarded with nothing but false relationships and, you know, fake sexual innuendos and, you know, yeah, exactly.
That's my favorite kind. Yes.
Yes. And so I took all that, and being at that period of time in most men's lives in their 30s, you realize why are things not working? It's because we were taught by older men from an older generation that were giving us advice that's decades old. So that show is basically him trying to cull through all this bad advice in order to grow up and become, you know, a man. Now, this new show, since I'm in a different facet of my life, the Book of Moron, is all about stupidity. And yes.
Yes, I know it well.
And how we have completely been controlled by, you know, image over substance, you know, clicks over, you know, actual reading. It's all about how the manipulation of our entire self-worth is basically on this
Instagram
screen
and
that
social
we're on
media.
Now.
Yeah, it's right. How many
it's funny.
Follow me? Yeah,
right. I started doing this before. You know, there was and writing about it kind of before this past 4 years of insanity, past when the GOP jumped the shark and became, you know, a Nazi tribe. And from working from doing the Male Intellect around the country, in the 2010, 2011, I started seeing how people were reacting to humor. Because humor is always the benchmark for our intelligence. And the dumber the humor, the dumber the culture gets.
I like you fart look back, jokes. I do like fart jokes.
There you go. But you look back at a time when Mark Twain was first part of the culture. We had a vocabulary that was massive. You try to quote Mark Twain nowadays using his verbal I can't even say. His verbosity.
Yeah.
Nobody would understand it. So, you know, everything has been dumbed down, and it's because it's been through a systematic. It's almost like we're not even aware what's being happened to us. A lot of the media's got problems with it. You know, we have a problem with it because the media likes to. It's all about money. So it's, you know, how do we dumb down and get people to buy things? So
if I knew,
anyway,
I wouldn't be doing this shit. Let me tell you.
Exactly. So it's turned into the show, which is how we recognize the inner moron in all of us. I mean, in the Book of Moron, it's the conceit of the show is that I discover that I'm in a coma. And so the stage is an alternate universe. And I have my five voices that we all have, my inner child, my voice of reason, my common sense.
My stupidity.
Can you guess? Well, that's my inner moron and my inner asshole. Which
oh, there we
is
go.
Our favorite. It's our favorite.
Yes, it's certainly my favorite when it's working. Right. When it's not.
I know. It's you. It needs all. But what's great about your inner asshole is he will pipe up whenever he wants with no censorship whatsoever.
Out.
Yes. So I become all these characters. So the shows that I do, it's not just one straight monologue. It's me performing a bunch of different roles that tell a whole bigger story. So it's kind of taking that stand-up idea a little higher level and much more so than just some, you know.
Well, then
70
minutes of stand-up, right? Yeah. Well, let me ask you though. So you've been working on this, as you said, you were workshopping this even back when you were doing Male Intellect in the ARC. So I assume, is it the kind of thing where you had 2.5 hours of material and then it's like, oh, how do I turn this into 75 minutes, one act, boom? How do you do this?
Yes, exactly. You have to, when you write these things, and as a writer, you have to overwrite. So, you know, you have a set up a punchline and then a tag and then a punchline on the tag and then another tag on the punchline. And then when you get it out and it's 2.5 hours long, you realize, okay, I can start cutting this instead of writing an 80-minute show, which is what it's supposed to be, and then realize, oh, shit, I got to cut 15 minutes of this, and now I'm back down to an hour. So it's worked out. You know, that's what a lot of, I think a lot of people who try to attempt to do these solo shows, what they don't realize is, number one, at least from my point of view, it's got to be funny nonstop. If it's not funny, it's just a lecture, and it's just somebody up there self-masturbating, you know, whatever their emotions are.
Well, if this, I would watch that if that were a girl.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. You will.
That's, yeah.
You know, you really need to see my first show, The Male Intellect at Oxymoron.
I really
I can tell just from where you're at.
Oh, yeah. I never grew up. Yes. You're right. It's got to be hilarious. And not just in the first 10 minutes when everything's hilarious.
Right.
You keep it going.
Throughout the whole show. And it's, I stay away from self personal stories. Just because unless you're Bette Midler or Billy Crystal or somebody famous, none of the tribe gives a shit about what your life story is, or they're not going to pay money to see it. Not in a successful touring show. I mean, I'm not going to go to Birmingham, Alabama and tell the story of how I got molested by an alcoholic stepfather, which is, you know, the basis of a lot of these kind of solo shows. Nobody could care less. Now, if I was Michael Douglas and I said I was molested by my father, oh yeah, sure, everybody'd be paying to see that. But it's only, from my point of view, it's only kind of the personal stories are very, you know, vanity driven, and they're very true and they're very realistic, but they're not productive.
Although I will have to say, I kind of agree with you, but I'm also seeing now, I guess it's the Me Too era, the woke era and all this, of every other comedian is a lesbian who was molested at some point or raped at some point. And this is their thing. It's like the audience feels compelled. Oh, she's pretty funny. But oh, let's give her a standing ovation because she suffered. Oh, but these are tremendously successful and they get specials on Netflix. So, you know.
You're a man after my own heart. I understand that because those to me are gimmicks. But I always thought if you would take a paper bag like Murray Langston, who did the Unknown Comic years ago, and if you could... Did you lose audio there? Or did I lose audio?
No. I'm losing
We're demanding phone. Coffee. Okay. But if you would take a paper bag and put it on everybody from me to Seinfeld to Leno to and just let people listen to the material and let them judge the material from the basis of it, then the gimmicks can't, you know, they're not going to propel you into anything. But that's a pipe dream. That's just...
Interesting that you mentioned Murray Langston, where we figure, oh, the whole thing's a gimmick. He's got a bag on the head. He wouldn't be that funny without the bag on the head, but he was. The liners, yeah.
He was a funny. Yeah, so they were all the joke, and the jokes weren't funny. That you didn't laugh. I mean, you could care less. So it's just an exercise to me in what material really holds up. I mean, I would love to take somebody's well-known material and they take my well-known material and both do it and see if it works. Now, I know my stuff.
Because it's also personality. No,
it is in a little bit, but the Male Intellect that I wrote in years ago, I've had other actors do it, and other actors in Europe are doing it. So it's the war. It's the text that really, you know, has to work. It doesn't matter if it's coming out of my
have
mouth.
Have you seen them do it in
your mouth?
Have you seen another actor do Male Intellect in English? And how did you take? Did you sit there and enjoy it, or is like, or were there moments when, oh, he's doing great, or that's better than I did it, and then other moments where, no.
Oh, both. Yeah. And, you know, because it's a process. Now, because it's 80 minutes and you're the only guy talking, it's a huge undertaking. So instead of, and I go about it, I studied with Sanford Meisner as far as acting before he passed away and for a number of years. So I'm familiar with the Meisner.
I'm very glad that you did not study with him after he passed away.
Oh, I did that as well.
Terrible.
You know, we'd sit and have picnics on the gravesite. So it was just so long as it was like a door exercise. I was knocking on the tombstone. But I understand and especially if you're acting within comedy, it has to be true. It has to be real, which is why most Republican comedians aren't funny, because it's not based in reality. It's not true. So when, you know, I have to teach the show to somebody else, regrettably, I got to throw all that out the window. I got to say, just mimic me until you get the lines. Cause there's a lot of staging. There's almost dance to it as far as where the body moves and how it accents a joke. So all of that, I've already figured out what doesn't work. So I give it to somebody, say, do exactly what I do. Once it's under your belt, then
and take
go
off.
Crazy.
But until then, what you need to do the R&D, I've done that. So
yes. Yeah, good way of putting it. Yeah,
let me ask you about, though, I assume, or maybe I'm assuming wrong, you wanted to be an actor from early on?
Yeah. Sure, so, I did, of course.
What steps did you take?
There's only room for about this many successful actors in the field of things. And I started realizing, okay, I did all kinds of guest parts and all kinds of co-starring roles and this. And then you realize, I've got these skills. Why don't I just combine all three of them together and be my own company? So I really don't have to worry about, getting rejected. So maybe it's a defense mechanism. I don't have to worry about, am I tall enough? Or all of a sudden they throw my role out because I'm not gay or black enough, or I'm not a lesbian, or it's whatever they change the role.
I've lost so many roles for not being a lesbian.
Yeah. Although, I'll tell you what, you're looking more and more like you could pass off as one.
I'm trying to, I volunteered to do the lesbian love scenes, and I just, it
does. I'm sure.
I get too excited.
You're standing in, there's a long line of you guys waiting to do those things.
You can see my pay is going like, it's a giveaway completely. But let me ask you, in terms of, it's one thing to do a one person show, to like book a hall for 3 weeks or 5 weeks or whatever it is, mm-hmm. and make a deal and rent and then try and sell tickets. It's quite another to have an enterprise where you're doing one show, you've got another show licensed that they're doing in Thailand, and then the same show another actor is doing in Los Angeles. How do you go from like, oh, I have a show, I hope somebody comes to see it, versus, oh, I'm a brand and people are coming to see my stuff and I'm getting residuals or whatever.
Well, how does that happen? All depending on the audience and the quality of the show. I mean, I'm kind of at that point now. It's just beginning to be that, where it's like, okay, I've done all this work and now it's starting to be a brand. But it's tough becoming a brand when you don't use television or movies. It's only been theater that people come to see me. You know, fortunately, when I first started doing the first show, it was at the end of that big comedy explosion where people were getting married, they were having kids, they weren't going to go to a comedy club every night of the week, or at least once a week. They had to wait and schedule when they were going to go out, get a babysitter, and you want to see something that's better than some guy, telling dick jokes with, while drinking beer. So,
I tell dick jokes while drinking borscht. It works.
Ah, very good.
Yeah, that's right. Hey, borscht jokes can't be beat. Can't get beat.
Ooh. Yeah. All right, well, as long as we're in puns, here's a nice systemic racist pun for you. Are all crackers in a Cracker Barrel white crackers? Saltines and sodas? Or do they serve off-colored crackers like Triscuits and Grahams? So there's your puns.
Yeah, thank you. That's horrifying there. Yeah. We're talking with Robert Dubac, by the way. Robert Dubac. We're back with Robert Dubac, ladies and gentlemen. And let me remind everybody that you should go see the Book of Moron at the Soho Playhouse. It is playing August 12th through October 3rd at the Playhouse. It's on Van Damme Street. I used to hear, where the hell is this theater? It's actually very, very easy to get to. You take the E train. It's one block away, right from
Spring Street.
Right over to
It is easy. It's I haven't been down in Soho in years, but it's like a whole different world now. I mean, everything's been rebuilt and, it's certainly not the old, when I was here in the 90s, doing the soap opera, Soho's a completely different place, that's for sure. And it's nice and small.
I also wanted to invite people, I think you have a couple of specials going on, one of which has to do with emergency workers or something like that.
These first 2 weeks are preview weeks. So, and it's just me getting my feet, cemented, and also it's when the press comes. There's all this precarious looks back from whatever's happening with COBO, whatever the Delta variant and everything is going on, we decided we're going to give out all of our frontline workers in hospitals or theater professionals. They've had to deal with this new stupidity virus, is what I call it. It's not a Delta virus, it's a stupidity virus. And they're suffering and we're penalizing them. They can't go out because all these other morons won't get a vaccine or won't take care of themselves. So I'm saying, okay, you guys come for free. We've got 50 tickets per night for the first preview nights. And all you gotta do is go to my website and there's a button, click on it and put your name in and you're good to go. So come and we can celebrate stupidity with
That's
with everybody from New York. and hopefully try to squash all the stupidity in New York, you know, one show at a time.
Now, also, I think there's another, I mean, do you have another offer going on during?
Well, then there's, you can get a 2-for-1 offer if you're not a frontline worker. But to be honest, we're not going to check. It's just that once the 50 tickets are given for free, you know, you can walk in. I can tell by looking at you, you're not a frontline worker, but we'll let you in.
Yeah, I'm kind of a rear line worker. You can tell that immediately. I just, but there, what we're telling people though is that if you're on the fence, you don't know if you want to go. Plus, you can pay and stuff. Yeah, there's ways to go much cheaper to see this show for the first week or two in previews at the Soho Playhouse to go see the Book of Moron. We want to send people also to I thought I wrote it. Yes, ROBERTDUBAC.com, D-U-B-A-C, so they can find all the information there. Buy tickets there.
It's all right there, and you're right. You let them come. It's just so that everyone knows the previews aren't really like a normal preview. I've done this show plenty of times, so it's all I'm trying to do is just get the feel of the theater down and getting the vibe. So it's not like you're going to come and see a workshop. It's just going to be a free ticket instead of having to pay it 3 weeks later, pay 50, 60 bucks for it. So,
but let me ask you also though, when you were booking or making this, your agent or whoever was saying, okay, we want to come to the Soho Playhouse from August, whatever, you probably planned this out, 3 months to half a year ago?
No, I planned it out about 4 weeks ago.
Really? So what I'm asking is, do you sort of regret like, oh shit, people are going to come in and they're going to have to sit there and not only enjoy the show, but we're going to have to mask them?
We didn't at the time. What was happening is that the governor allowed theaters to open up at a certain time. Now, as we know, a big Broadway musical or a big show, you can't just flip the switch and walk in and put on the show. You have to rehearse. There's months. That's why most shows are not opening up till the end of September, October, November. So I thought there'd be this gap where there's not a lot of competition, because that's the real trouble in New York is there's so many shows and you're competing, advertising dollars. I mean, how do you let people know, other than with Dave's Gone By, how do you let people know what's going on? So I thought coming in at that time would have been, and it has worked out pretty well because there's not as many shows that are up, but then the Delta variant came through. And it is kind of, I mean, I've got my own personal opinion on it. I don't think that those of us who've been vaccinated have anything to worry about. If you want to wear a mask while you're in the performance,
That won't be your call. I think
it won't be. Yeah, but exactly. But once you're inside, if you paint a little, smiley face on your mask, at least we'll know you're laughing. But, and just show us your card that you've been vaccinated. I don't think there's anything to worry about.
No, nothing to worry about. But is it going to be weird doing comedy, doing a show to people who are instead of going ha ha ha, they're like ha ha ha?
Well, I'll let you know by Friday morning.
Well, have you performed
Thursdays
in front of in the past year and a half? Have you done shows?
Yes, they've been outdoor shows. So we've been doing outdoors, and people haven't had to mask up, obviously. So we are thinking of just blowing a hole in the roof, so that it feels like it's outdoors, so we don't have to. We'll just put a big mask over the roof, the hole in the roof of the theater.
But you haven't heard any with Delta going. You haven't heard these no lockdown crap or this is going to be postponed.
I'm not. No. Look, if it is postponed, just tell me where you live. I'll come and do the show at your house. It's just me. It's not. It's not a big. It's me and my five inner voices. And
I have so many more, but the others are all psychotic. It's a terrifying thing.
I hear one laughing in the background. Yes.
That's my dear wife, Miriam Libby. We have 21 and a half beautiful, 15 are beautiful. The rest inbreeding.
You sound like you're an evangelical. You got that many kids?
Oh yeah. Well, there's only one part of me that isn't in pain all the time, and I use it as much as I can I can. I see.
your name should be Duggerstein, I guess, right?
Oh, there you go. Thank you very much. We're talking with Robert Duback here. I want to. I also have, even though you are doing the Book of Moron, there is another show that you're working on, and God knows, as a rabbi, I'm curious about this.
Yes, you'd love this.
It's called Stand Up Jesus. Oh, yeah, I hate that name. But tell us what the hell that is.
Well, it's so as earlier in this interview, I was saying, you know, the shows really develop. And I think if you follow a comedian's life, their material is very similar to what Mark Twain would do, where at the end of Mark Twain's life, he was completely against religion. He had gone through so much suffering and realized that this is, you know, bullshit with what they were passing off on people. And that was later in his life. It was very political midlife. And then, of course, there were all the coming to life and growing up with Huck Finn and those kind of writings earlier on in his career. And I think you see that with a lot of comedians. They start out with the dick jokes and they get into politics. And now they, you know, so this is my.
I started out with dick jokes. I got to do vulva jokes.
Oh,
really? I got so much more. I can't tell you. Yes.
I hear they're electric now.
Oh, what?
I don't Volvo, know. Volvo.
Oh, yeah.
I was sorry. I'm moving too fast here.
I lost the path on that.
That's okay. So the new show, Stand Up Jesus, I come back as Jesus, as a stand-up comedian, because I realized last time I was here, when you preach without punchlines, you get crucified. So I've added punchlines, and Dad has Alzheimer's, so I'm taking over the family business, and I've been told by a lot of my peers, it's some of the best stuff I've written. And I've done it about four or five times. So I hope to, while I'm doing the Book of Moron on stage at the Soho Playhouse, that a lot of times that when I'm working on these shows, I will work on little pieces like as an encore of a new show. So I'll be doing pieces of that. And they also have at the Soho Playhouse an underneath level that's a small theater, about 50 seats. So I'll probably do a couple of workshops down there.
Brilliant. But let me ask you.
Yeah.
First of all, you got one show called The Book of Moron. Now you got the Jesus. Have you taken any protest crap? Has anybody said, oh, how dare you?
I can't wait. I can't wait to have more. I want to open up in Birmingham. I want to open up in the Bible Belt. I want people to picket it. Yeah, I mean, you know, when Monty Python did Life of Brian, they had this much publicity expense that they could use. They had no idea that it was going to be a success. They had just a little bit of money to pay for advertising. And the Catholic Church jumped down their throats and it became huge. So I'm going to go after that same model. I'm going to look for people who want to tar and feather me anywhere in the country, because I think we're at a time for this show that the entire country is fed up with politics and religion and the far evangelical right trying to jam, you know, the proselytization of religion. And they've completely, it's based from the Book of Moron, where people take information and exaggerate it and make it and politicize it. And that's what's happened with religion. And it's time to kind of bring the hammer down on, you know, these false beliefs.
Now, let me ask you, as you do monologues, and I think that one of the cool things about monologues and doing them in a theater is that they have to be funny, but they don't have to be as constantly funny as going into a club and doing stand-up. But mm-hmm. Did you go that route for a while? Did you do the 10 minutes here, the 15 minutes at 3 a.m. at Stand Up New York or Governors or wherever the hell else? What are your memories of that? Any hell gigs that you really remember? Like, why do I do this?
Oh, I mean, we all have those. As a stand-up comic, we all have those. I mean, I can remember doing a show with another comedian. It was one of the back in when comedy was first exploding in the 80s. Everybody thought they could put a microphone up in their bar and have a stand-up comedian. So we get in to do this show, and the television is on above the stage, you know. And they're watching a football game. Okay. So the owner comes up and says, okay, time to go on. I says, what do you mean? It's just time to go on. Go up and turn the television off. And
do your good luck. Wait. They could have at least, did they do it during like,
No. Halftime. It's 4 o'clock, dude, or 6 o'clock.
And whatever the time
was. Yeah. So I go, oh, fuck. So I go up and I turn it off and I start doing the act. And there's obviously this glaze that's over, you know, all these guys' eyes and these people sitting there watching the game. And after 30, 35 seconds, a guy just gets up out of his chair, walks past me on stage, turns the television back on, and then goes back and sits down. And I says, okay, show's over. I guess you'd rather see the opening act. instead of me.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that. Speaking of opening act, did you open for like the Allman Brothers or Dickie Betts or people like that?
Oh, sure. I mean, I started out it was myself, actually, as everybody knows, Steve Martin was doing rock and roll, opening for rock and roll bands when he first started out. And it was another comedian by the name of Gary Muledeer. And there was me and Chris Bliss. And we were kind of the guys that did open for all the acts because we had a lot of visual stuff. And it's very hard at that time. You couldn't really just do plain old stand-up. So you had this. I used to do a magic act that was kind of a carrot top magic act where with a rock and roll audience, it's extremely easy because they're high as kites. So doing a magic trick isn't that difficult.
Right. Yeah.
You do a magic trick or you make a bird appear and then you fold it up because it's made out of rubber or something, you know, and it's, oh, wow, this guy's, you act like you smoke a joint. And look, back then, you know, we had all kinds of laws that prevented all that stuff. And you, so there was
so
a much
more.
So
you had them on your side just by intimating that yes, you were part of the crew.
Like, exactly.
Oh, he's cool. He's with that. Yeah.
I mean, I would actually roll a joint, light it up. The fume, the aroma would get out to the first row, so they realized it really was pot, and then I'd make it disappear. So I'm like, oh, the cops are coming, boom. So it's, you know, very hacky kind of humor, but still,
it worked.
You know, of course. So I worked for years with probably every rock and roll band. I mean, when I finished up, I was open for Jimmy Buffett, Linda Ronstadt, Kenny Loggins. I mean, these probably are names that nobody knows about anymore.
But opening for, I always wonder about this. Like, do you even get to wave at them, shake their hands, or did you get to hang with them? Or do you just,
oh, yeah,
you're gone, they're gone, what? No.
Oh, no. I mean, I was kind of like the guy on tour with them. So I would tour on the bus.
Really?
Every once in a while, I'd get on the plane with them. And yeah, so it was just part of the band, kind of, you know, it's like a.
So do you have any stories about Linda Rollins? Any rock and roll stories?
A lot of rock and roll stories. It's good, better for a rock and roll interview.
I have kidney stones, so this that's yeah. Rocks. Yes.
I'd rather protect the peoplehood that it involves. Because look, as the old joke goes, when if you remember anything in rock and roll in the 70s, you weren't really there. So. We don't want to, you know, I don't want to bring people I can throw under the bus or the dead ones, I guess. So.
Tell me a story about a rock and roller, but don't mention a name.
Okay. I was in New York. I was doing an old, do you remember, was it still around? Trax, the club Trax. It was named after heroin. It was a punk and a rock and roll club down on the Lower East Side. I'm doing, and I can mention this because the guy's dead.
Oh, yeah, do it.
So we're
doing. Pete Seeger is at Trax doing lines. No, I'm. Uh oh. Isn't this funny? Just as he's about to tell this story, he freezes. Oh, this is kind of interesting. Robert Dubac, are you there? Robert, you're froze. You're completely frozen. Well, let me admit. Yeah, he may not know, or he may have to log off. Hold on. Shalom, David. Hold on. Let me put David on just in case we've lost him. Robert, you might have to log in and log. I don't know why you're suddenly gone. This is very disturbing. But very much alive is David Sheward, who is here to play the today, yesterday game. The hello, you. I love that shirt. I like that shirt very much. How are you? We missed you last week. While you are here, I'm going to play some Robert Dubac, an intro for his previous show, and then I'll bring Dave in to continue the Dave's Gone By Facebook, your podcast, your programming of the stream, and then you can play the today, yesterday game. So here is a bit of Robert Dubac doing the stand-up.
Ma'am, you're sitting right in the front. I'm just going to ask you a question, okay? That's all. I'm not going to ask you how old you are. How much you weigh? Is sex a sin, or is it a skill? Depends who you're with. If you're having sex with someone's married to someone else, that's considered a sin. If you're having sex with yourself, that's a skill. I have a wedding band, so I'm married, but is it a same-sex marriage? Probably. What? Isn't that what marriage is? The same sex over and over again? Because it's the middle of the night, I'm in an alley, and I watch the news. Yeah, you watch the news, you know you're going to get mugged once in your lifetime. You watch cable news twice. What do I believe? Do I believe in God or Allah or Yahweh or something more powerful like Oprah? It's not panic. How do you wake up from a coma? That was not rhetorical. Let's use our brains here, okay? There's hundreds of us, so that's what? 65, 70 brains?
Robert?
What?
Angry about the stand-up show.
Who wrote that in? That's great. Somebody just wrote in, we lost Robert momentarily because Jesus was angry about your doing the show. So Robert, I'm Dave Lefkowitz. Hello, everybody. You're watching The Dave's Gone By, Facebook, your podcast, your programio of the stream. Rabbi Sol took the opportunity. He really, really was holding back and constipated and had to use the bathroom. So I'm now back hosting the program. So Robert, Rabbi Sol sends his apologies.
Oh, that's quite all right. I actually,
I
like you. You are much prettier.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you ever so much. Oh, you flatterer.
Somebody
you.
Somebody in Texas said his show
was great. Someone in Texas. Who's the name or first name?
It's Bill Kirchenbauer.
Oh, my God.
Bill Kirchenbauer.
Who was a guest on the show 2 months ago. He's a comedian. Bill Kirchenbauer said your show, he's seen your show, and it's great.
He saw the first workshop of Stand Up Jesus. I'm sorry, we're excluding who else has joined.
Well, yeah,
I'm sorry to be rude.
But this is, first of all, let me do proper introductions. So we've got Robert Duback, who had been talking to Rabbi Sol, but then there was some Jesus-like interference, and we lost him. So I came on to continue the rest of the show and play the Today Yesterday quiz. But Robert Duback is doing not the Jesus show, but he's doing the Book of Moron, August 12th. Yes. Through October 3rd at the Soho Playhouse on Van Damme Street. Go see it. And there's also lots of ways to see it very inexpensively during the preview period. If you've been a frontline worker, they want to let you in for free. They want to give you that treat. There's also some BOGO opportunities within the first week or two. And then a BOGO, buy one, get one free. And then after that, go see the show.
And just go to the website where everything's there. It's robertduback.com.
RobertDuback.com. And if you're on the Facebook page, my wife has posted the information in the chat, so you can go to that link and find it.
Thanks, honey.
Now, speaking of people who are darling, also in the neighborhood with us right now is the wonderful, the delightful David.
Look at his shirt.
I saw it. Isn't that shirt lovely?
David looks great.
David Sheward. He is the former managing editor of Backstage. He's also the former head of the drama desk. He is now a writer, a theater critic for CulturalWeekly.com as well. No, CulturalDaily.com.
Cultural Daily.
See, 1 week goes by, I don't do it, I forget everything. TheaterLife.com as well as his blog, The David Desk. Well, you were away last week. You were on vacation. Uh-huh. Where were you, in Maine still?
Yes. We were in Maine, and we got back that Saturday. We had to check out of the Airbnb. And so I've been back for a week, and it was lovely. Hi, how are you?
Good. Nice to meet you, virtually.
Nice to meet you, Robert. Yeah. We had a great time. We stayed near Portland and just went to the beach and hung around and ate lobster. And
oh, yeah. Did you go into restaurants?
Fried clams. What?
Did you go into places to like eat and shop, yeah, as opposed to not or take out everything?
Oh yeah, yes.
So cool. Because also, I mean, Rabbi Sol was talking with Robert about his doing a show in a couple of weeks, and the audience having to basically come in fully masked, stay there as per New York rules, fully masked. One of you heard, you're going to start teaching in a couple of weeks. So what have you heard now? Are they going to make the kids mask up the whole day? Is that the deal?
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably. I haven't heard for sure, but probably there will be a I would imagine there's going to be a mask mandate because I was going to tell a joke about the governor, but then I just realized, oops, he may not be the governor.
Cuomo.
Yes, I, you know, he's sexual. He's got a Cuomo. He's a Cuomo sexual. So there you go. That's yep. I don't
even know. That's right.
Thank
that's
you. So
that's
much.
a pretty good thing, you know.
So, well, anyway, by the way, I'm just saying to Robert, and we're also sort of killing time because go figure, the person who's supposed to join us and will, I presume, David, you're better than I am with these kind of word things. What's the difference between assume and presume?
Assume and presume?
Yeah.
Well, assume, if you saw that episode of The Odd Couple, means you make an ass out of you and me.
Right. But a presumption has to do with going forward. Anyway, what we're saying is, Leslie,
Dave, I assume that you know what presume means.
That's presumptive.
Oh, that day. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we resume now. So
yes.
Until
if you're killing time, both Daves, you do know that lobster was actually considered terrible. When we first landed in this country, it was so much of it on the beach, and the Native Americans didn't want anything to do with it, and you couldn't get rid of it. It was almost considered
peasant
kind of food until we started, you know, making them go extinct.
And now it's like the most expensive thing on the menu.
Exactly.
Well, they did the same thing with tilapia. Tilapia was like a ridiculous little crappy ground fish, and then it was called something else. And then
called crappy little ground fish.
That was, you would literally get it in the supermarket, frozen crappy little ground fish in Trader Joe's. But they renamed it tilapia, and they tacked an extra like $8 onto a pound. And now it's this, ooh, tilapia in the red. It was crappy little ground fish.
Oh, speaking of theater,
which is a crappy little ground fish most of the time.
Well, you were kind of beforehand because Robert's show is going to be at the
Soho Playhouse.
Of course.
Yeah.
Is tonight I am going back into live theater to see Shakespeare in the Park's production of Merry Wives in Central Park, which I'm really looking forward to. It's the first time. I mean, I've been to one or two shows since the pandemic, but this is the first time I've been to Shakespeare in the Park in 2 years. So that's exciting.
And the weather looks like it's going to be perfect for it. So it sounds, have they reviewed it yet? Has that officially?
No, it opens on Monday. It opens Monday.
Cool.
They had to delay the opening because the leading man had an accident, but he's healed up now. And
I'm sorry, but you know.
And some cast members reported that they tested positive for COVID, so they had to go into quarantine. I'm very interested. It'll be interesting to see what happens on Broadway.
Well, yeah, I mean, every show is going to be, because I've been working in a school district, and there was a point when I first got the job about a year ago, when almost every day, like two or three times a week, we get a letter from the superintendent saying, because we have three buildings in our school district, and the letter would be like, three students have tested positive in this school, they haven't touched anybody, they haven't been near anybody, and we've contact traced everybody near them. So we're not changing anything, we're just letting you know those kids will be out for 2 weeks. and this staff member, that was more difficult, that affected more people. This teacher has... they won't mention by name, but they say, we've lost this particular teacher for this period of time. Breakthrough will happen. I can't imagine.
I hate to politicize this whole thing, but those of us that have gotten vaccines and have taken care of ourselves, why are we now being penalized to prevent measles, everything else is still there.
Exactly.
We're still carrying those viruses around, but everybody's vaccinated, so they're not catching them. So why is it that now this responsibility of an entire group of people that says, well, I'm not going to follow what you said to start with and not wear a mask. And now, oh, I'm at risk. You need to wear a mask to save my butt. I mean, why is this?
Well, I'm also
I'll tell you why. It's because underneath it all, it's they want to make Biden look bad so Trump can get reelected.
Well, of course.
That's it. That's the whole thing. They want to make Biden look bad.
The thing is, as a progressive or Democrat, we really need to grow some stones and just push back and say, man, fuck you guys, basically.
Well, I have no problem.
I do it with jokes, but
You have no problem wearing a mask.
I have no problem wearing a mask. I don't see what the big deal is. I don't see, you know, ooh, I don't want to wear a mask. It'll inhibit me. Ooh.
Well, no, I agree. There's nothing. I will wear one, especially, you know, but to mandate it and to do this entire reversal of what they were against in the very beginning now for the way things have changed because they just want to make a political party look bad. Why can't we just all kind of have a kumbaya moment here and basically say, I actually want to commit murder. And I'm not going to wear my mask. And if you're not protected,
well, it's a whole, we can extrapolate a whole bunch of stuff from that. I mean, why is Tucker Carlson going to Hungary and praising a dictator?
Yeah, I know.
Because he wants to have a dictator here in the US.
I have a great dream of as we all get older and some of us have come down with a terminal disease, I want to get together a 80-year-old group of ninja assassins that are going to take somebody out before they go out with them. So we can, it's all, yes.
I got a text from Leslie saying, waiting to get in.
Yeah, I don't see her yet. I'll let you know. I texted her to
the
say.
Waiting room. Check the waiting room.
I get a message from the waiting room. There's nothing.
So does everybody think that while we're waiting that Cuomo will and should resign?
I want to see him impeached so that he has a fair trial. And if in the trial they discover there's is unimpeachable evidence that he used his, his position to have a position, then yes, he should quit or be fired. But to fire him before he's being proven guilty, I don't like that idea. You know.
Well, under New York law, it's different than with the president. Once the if a governor is impeached, he's out of office.
Yeah. Yeah.
If he's found not guilty, then he comes back in. So they're going to impeach him. It's going to happen.
Right.
They have to.
But I also think we really, really need in this country, even during this period, to understand the difference between like an old guy who sees a pretty girl and hits on her, even though it's creepy, versus sexual assault.
But that's the question, because it's not just Cuomo. Cuomo is not just accused of, oh, you're so pretty, you want to go on a date? He's accused of groping under the shirt and grabbing breasts and all that stuff.
That's how I celebrate my afternoons.
Yeah, yourself, but you're grabbing your own breasts. talking about somebody. You can grab your own all you want. Yeah.
No, I think what it really is about for me is assuming he didn't rape anybody, so even the grope, maybe grab the girl's ass, even, that's old school. But if he's in this position and somebody is beneath him, not literally, and he's like, if you don't sleep with me, the implication is that you won't be in the organization, you know? Leslie, I'm trying, it says she's in the waiting room. I'm trying to.
You want help?
There's nothing I can do. She's trying to join.
Okay.
And there's nothing to do yet.
Tell her to. Oh, you can't talk to her, right? I say just what I did is
you
I just completely
her.
Shut down and re-linked myself.
Or she could try her telephone.
Yeah,
she could try her telephone rather than her computer, which she's done before.
So she's trying. But anyway, we lost her. Do you disagree with me that about that, or Robert? Because you seem to be, even though you're left liberal, there are things that
I'm a left liberal with a gun. Kind of thing. You know, that's basically it. But you know, the idea that we're holding people accountable for their sexual misconduct in political office instead of their political misconduct in political office is what always annoys me, because it's the sexual thing is the easy way to go after somebody. And I know it shouldn't happen, and I know people, you know, hopefully the public would rise up against it and say, okay, we're not going to vote for you again. Hi there.
Hello. Hello. Wait.
Hello.
Well, she'll have to unmute. Unmute Les. She knows. And tilt your phone.
Oh, it's...
I think that,
there you go. But, you need some, if nothing Les, else, still get anybody off.
He's not, but if he's not punished, I mean, right. If he's not, if there's not some kind of consequence, the message is, oh, this is okay. Oh,
get away with it. Right. Exactly.
You can do it again.
I agree with you there too. So, I mean, it's not that it's a fine line. It's just, it's blurred.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay to grab a straight, it's okay to assault a state trooper.
So,
I didn't know you were talking about Cuomo, even though I didn't hear the beginning of it.
So, Leslie, as someone who has sexually assaulted many, many people, what are your thoughts on?
How did you know? I thought it was a well-kept secret.
I know. Usually you're wearing that mask, Leslie.
Yes, I don't know what everybody else has already said previously. All I know is that I was very happy with him as a governor. I'm not happy with him as the sexual predator, but I know that in his mind he doesn't think he is one. I know he doesn't think he is one. I bet he could take a polygraph test and pass because he is so sure in his mind that what he is doing is not sexual assault. And that's really sad.
Well, that's what's happened with the country is that the narcissists have risen from the pool of the regular culture, and they're all, you know, completely convinced what they're doing is acceptable because
which means polygraphs don't work for shit these days. I mean,
well, they never did. Yeah.
No, but let me ask you a serious question that won't sound serious. But as an actress going into the 1960s, 70s, 80s, I imagine you had your ass grabbed here and there. You got whistled at. You took shit from men. That was kind of okay back then, even though it wasn't okay. I mean, looking back now, do you go, oh my God, I wish I could have prosecuted them or had them fired or brought them up on charges?
The worst was not in show business. The worst was in teaching.
Okay.
In show business, I was led by many, many great gay men who could care less that I was, you know, they had nothing. There were, I would get yelled at for being late. I would get, which, you know, I have
you
a genetic.
You late, Leslie?
I know. I have a genetic predisposition. I would get yelled at when I did musicals for being off key or off bass or off tone because I'm not a singer. I was lucky enough to look a little like Lauren Bacall and sound like her, so I got roles, but not because I was a singer. And then I became a director and I didn't harass anybody else. But when I was in teaching, my last principal, not the early ones, my first principal was a former rabbi and was the dearest man in the whole world. My final principal,
Gail Gordon, right?
Yes, Gail Gordon, that was the guy. There was actually a similarity. He had a mustache.
Mustaches
were not popular. And this man, and I had the same persuasion ethnically as Cuomo. I don't want to stereotype.
Italian, just say the fucking word Italian. Jesus, the same.
Wait, go ahead.
But he had
a Guido.
He had a sense of entitlement that I had never seen before in my life to anything. And I was the chapter chairperson for the union, and the rule was that if you wanted to place any kind of thing against the principal, you had to have 100% of the teachers sign up beforehand. You couldn't go and say three people said. You had to have, so no matter what he did, and he was always touching, he was always hugging, he was always saying things, he was always whispering in people's ears, and I would say, this is inappropriate. If it was if I was there, if he was doing it to me, either way, it was inappropriate. And then I would try, and the other teachers would come and say that, and I would say, we have to sign up together. We have to stand in unity. We cannot, and nobody would sign because everybody was so fucking afraid. I understand this culture. I understand what happened.
And it took. I was going to say, it took kind of this moment of critical mass for it to finally, you know, tip over, which is what's interesting about human beings is they won't do it unless somebody else jumps on the bus.
And I went to the union and I said, this is going on. And they said, it's going on everywhere. Yeah. If you can get your teachers, and I couldn't. It went from the very pretty young girls to the, you know, the older people like myself. It didn't matter. He was, I will say that, he was equally harassed.
Equal offender.
Equal opportunity
offender. But but it was really, and I'd never had that. It was not like I was starting my career that way. I ended my career that way. Hmm. In fact, I took a medical leave at the time. I had had many accidents I'd had a couple of whiplashes. Oh. And I really couldn't, you know, I wear that collar sometimes. I still have problems.
Yeah, those are pain in the neck.
And one of them, the last one, happened on the school grounds during those 3 days. I'm sorry, do you want me to take all this time to tell this story? I'm
well, finish her up and then we'll get on.
All right, I'll finish her up. Yeah, I was already late to start with. And so I was carrying a wire bookcase up a staircase and I turned around and somebody opened the door into me. I was coming up like this and right into the bookcase, right into my face. So the two things I was worried about was A, I didn't fall down the stairs, and B, was my nose broken, because, you know, important things like what do I look like? So they rushed me to the hospital and I had x-rays taken. And what they discovered was that it was the final, after two others, one up at the O'Neill, it was the final blow literally to my neck. I have 5-6 injuries that I've had forever. So I took a medical leave, a 6-month medical leave. And when I came back, I got this whole oily, and oily was the word I had for him, oily. I got this thing about, well, we can't put you back in the library where you were. So we're going to give you a pre-K class, which he thought was a terrible thing, which I thought was a terrible thing. And it turned out to be the best year of teaching I ever had. Wow. Because 3 years old, and well, they were 4 years old, 4 year old children make you well. They make you healthy. They give you everything. It's like it comes out of their fingertips into your body when you're with them. I never knew that. I would have been a pre-K kindergarten forever, and I would have stayed forever had I known that.
You know, Leslie, if you want to do it again, we just added pre-K to the school. This is not a joke. The district I'm in, we never had pre-K. We're having it starting this semester, this year.
Take a lunch hour and go into the room, if it's not their sleep time, and ask the teacher if you can just sit in and watch what goes on. Little kids come up and they hug you, and basically they're saying, teach me, help me, let me learn. Give me something.
That's the last thing we want in a pandemic. I don't want any child
hugs. I know it's not the pandemic's not the right time. I understand that.
Yeah.
But what they will give you in return is hugs and human contact and the sense that there is a future. You really see it when you see these. I mean, I had a kid. He's grown up. He's an adult man. You met him. But my point is, there's something about this that I had forgotten over many years. I you're smiling as if you know. I don't know who you are. I'm so sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Forgive me for not introducing. Let's get on with the show, because we have a today, yesterday quiz. And Robert, I do apologize if we're going over your available time with us, but I want you to stay.
I'm so sorry.
Play the game with us. But we're having a fabulous time. But let me explain who you are. This is the Today, Yesterday trivia quiz. We do it every week, and we're playing it with, first of all, our weekly wonderful person, Leslie Hoban Blake. She is a podcaster now. She's also a theater director. You can find her on Critics Circle on YouTube, as well as Two on the Aisle. We also have David Sheward, who is the former head of the Drama Desk. And
previously reigning champ.
And the reigning champ of the
trivia. But I won last week because the reigning champ wasn't here. Go ahead.
And our gentleman joiner here is the actor and the Leslie, I'll ask you, is it monologist or monologist?
Monologist, but you're doing that show downtown, aren't you?
Yes, at the Soho Playhouse.
Because I can see your last name. Oh, of course. I just read about it. You're down at the Theater 54.
The Soho Playhouse.
The book
of Moron.
Wrong, yeah. Small theater. Book of Moron. Yes.
Yes.
I just sent Charlie a note about it. I want to try to go see it.
Oh, good. Well,
he also did The Male Intellect and Oxymoron a couple of years, about 5 years back.
Sorry, I don't remember those. Fine. This I know about.
But I don't watch New York too much.
Robert Dubac is with us. David Sheward, Leslie Hoban Blake. Are you all ready to play the Today, Yesterday game?
No, I'm sorry. I'm too tired now. I'm going to leave now.
You'll have to bear with me, because I'm going to figure out what the game's about, because I've never played.
I'll give you the rules. Oh, and do you happen to have, by any chance, it can be a pen, a pencil, a crayon, blood, and a scrap piece of paper. You'll need that for the very end of the game. That's you'll need it immediately. So here we go. Here's the rules. You guys know it, but Robert, this is new for you. It's a trivia quiz. And so there's 9 questions. So everybody, is that your lovely wife?
Yes, she has a great elbow. She's in the back.
Hello, wife. Wave. Hi. Hello there. You are welcome to team with her on certain on questions. Because this is not an easy quiz. It's a mix of questions
Do I get a handicap of any sorts?
I can cut off your knees, but that would be very painful. But some of the questions.
I don't have knees. As you can tell, I don't have knees. I've been sitting here this whole time. Yeah.
No pants either.
Jeffrey Toobin. Right. Okay.
So, some questions are very direct, normal-ish. Some are like, oh, you just got to guess because they're ridiculous and so forth. Everybody gets three questions each. There are three rounds. And then by the end of the ninth question, we either have a winner or we have a tiebreaker. And then, but everybody does a tiebreaker anyway, just for fun. Now, each question is worth 2 points. If you get it right, if you get it wrong, no points, but one of the other contestants gets to steal that question.
Can I just sell all my points now?
That's such a Jewish thing to say, and you're not even. So the one thing I will ask from you, Robert Duback, is can you kindly pick a number between 1 and 6 and tell me what it is?
The number between 1 and 6 is 3.
Great. Okay. And Leslie Hoban Blake, ladies second. So what number would you like to?
I'll take 6, please.
Leslie is 6. And David Sheward?
4.
4. Okay.
Different numbers today.
Oh, I have 2-letter Ds, so I better do S for Sheward. You said 4. Okay. What I'm going to do, Robert, so you know, is roll a digital die. The die came up number 5, which is right between Leslie and David, so I'm going to have to roll it again. And this time it comes up directly a number 3, which is Robert Duboc's number. Robert, you get to choose whether you want to go first, second, or third.
I'll go third.
Oh, okay. So we're going to roll the die again. Do-do-do-do-do. This is the whole game, by the way. Isn't it fun? All right, it comes up. Number 2. So that is closest to I make those kinds of jokes.
Get it.
Second closest to David Sheward. David, do you want to go second, first or second?
I'll go first.
First. Sheward first.
Monsieur.
You don't have a choice.
Robert wanted to go third. So we have David Sheward going first, Leslie going second, and Robert Duback going
Robert,
third.
You missed it. Normally, we have to oil up and go into a cage to fight when it comes between two numbers. I don't know why he's not doing that today.
He's being gallant, I guess. Or
oh, is that it?
Yeah.
For Robert, but papa moi, merci.
Yes. Sorry.
Normally, I'm being goofus. All right, here we go. So we're going to start with. I think I gave you all the rules that you need to know for now. So David Sheward, being the first one up. Your first question. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Here we go. The year. And Robert, I missed the whole point of the quiz that every single one of these questions, all of these are based on things that happened on this date, August 7th, in history. So it could have been August 100 years ago, 100, 500.
Honey, you want to pull up August 7th on Google for me, please?
It's a waste of time, Robert, because he's lying. That's not the point of the game.
He has
changed the whole set of rules.
It's a 10.
Okay.
Whatever he can pull out of his whatever orifice he's using at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you ever so much.
You're welcome, David.
David Sheward, 1782 was the year. This is actually a pretty normal-ish multiple choice question.
Okay.
George Washington orders the creation of an award to honor soldiers wounded in battle. It was a cloth badge in the shape of a Purple Heart. Only it wasn't called the Purple Heart back then. What was it called? A, the Combat Beret Badge. B, the Badge of Military Merit. C, the Order of Sacrifice. D, the Order of Distinguished Service.
Huh. Well, it could be any one of those. Read them again.
Of course. So Purple Heart was originally called A, the Combat Beret Badge, B, the Badge of Military Merit, C, the Order of Sacrifice, or D, the Order of Distinguished Service.
Order of Distinguished Service, I think that sounds like that's the best. I'm going to go with Order of Distinguished Service.
And is that your final answer?
Yes.
Well, I'm afraid your answer distinks. That is not the correct one. Okay. So somebody else gets to steal, and we're going to find out who by rolling our die. Let me take the music down and find the die again. Hold on. Too many things open on my... Here it is. We're going to roll this die, and the die comes up number 4, which is, well, David Sheward's number, but it is closest to Robert Duback. So, because you rolled a... Or you asked for a 3.
Sacrifice.
The order of sacrifice. Is that your final answer?
Yes, it is.
Well, I appreciate the sacrifice you made to be on this program today, but I'm afraid that is not the correct answer, Robert Duback. So, Leslie Hoban Blake, you get to steal this question for 2 points.
Tell me what the 2 that are left are, because I've lost track. Thank you.
Your options are... The Combat Beret Badge, the Badge of Military Merit.
I'll go with Military Merit.
Is that your final
answer? It's a guess. It's a pure guess. It's my final guess.
Well, you have done meritorious service to this program, Leslie Hoban Blake, by getting on the board with 2 points.
I've done meritorious service by getting up this morning. Go ahead. I'm sorry. That's it.
Well, I'm done. Glad to see you, Les. Believe me.
Thank you.
So Leslie is leading the game so far, 2 points. But hey, only had 1 question. So much can happen. And this next question goes directly now to Leslie. So you can build on your lead if you get this right. It's also a multiple choice.
Oh, and here, goody. Last time we played, I had no multiple choices. Jesus.
This time you do. 1820 was the year. So on this day, on August 7th, 1820, it's a multiple choice, and I'm so excited about that. Oh, this is so important. I'll be right there.
Okay.
Can we talk amongst ourselves?
Sure. What does 810 mean? Does anyone know?
It's his 810th show. 810th. I do know.
I've only done this 810th. Look what came in the mail.
A new potato.
Is it a new potato? It's a new potato.
Oh, wow. A neutered potato.
Yes.
And the rationale behind the new potato is?
Well, this question has to do because...
Oh, David,
he's a smoky smell.
He's hefty.
Yeah, he's he can use a little...
he's a big boy.
No fat-shaming potato.
He's a little baked, is he? I see. Is that how they send your weed these days in a potato? Is that the whole...
Well, that's why they have appeal. Okay, here we go. 1820 was the year. Many sources give this date as the first time potatoes were planted in Hawaii. Which of these is the Hawaiian word for potato?
Oh,
is it A, melehune, B, kulina, C, lakika, or D, uwala kahiki?
How the hell would I know? All right, try it again.
Could you spell those names?
There's no root word for me to go to try to figure out potato in the name of that. All right, I will count the vowels. Go ahead, do it again.
Okay, again, which of these is the Hawaiian word for potato? A, melehune, B, kulina, C, lakika, D, uwala kahiki.
Never been to Hawaii. I don't have a bit of a clue. I'll go with the first one you said. I have no idea.
Melehune is the
first one. Sure. It sounds nice. That's all.
Leslie, you may go to Hawaii to get laid, but you don't get the right answer on get laid. You'll joke. Okay, but no, melehune is not the word for potato. So let us roll the die and see who can steal this question. It comes up the big old number 2, which is closest again to Robert Duback. So Robert, you can try and steal this question if you know you're Hawaiian. Which is the word for potato? Is it kulina, lakika, or uwala kahiki?
I will say kuhina.
I'm
making up a new word.
So yeah.
What was the second?
Why not? He did.
Yeah, of course.
Second one is kulina.
Kulina. Let's go with kulina.
Well, I appreciate I had a pun there. It didn't work. Hold it. Okay. No, it was a very cool answer. but not the correct one. So no, no, no. We have a steal opportunity here. Here we go.
All right.
So is it the word for potato? It's a little Hawaiian music there. Is it lakika or wala kahiki?
Well, I'm wearing a Hawaiian shirt, so I should know.
Yes. Wow.
And I have been to Hawaii, but we didn't have potatoes while we were there. So let's see. So it's lakika?
Right.
Or wala?
Wala kahiki.
Wala kahiki.
Or Don Ho.
Oh, we can add Don Ho to to Lin-Manuel and all the other
or
things. That Don Ho, I like that one.
If
okay.
Ida, as they used to say on Laugh-In, if Ida Lupino married Don Ho, she'd be Idaho.
I like that.
That's what they used to say.
Sock it to me. All right.
Nixon's favorite show.
Yeah, Lakika.
Really?
Lakika. That your final answer. Lakika. Although I got a kick out of your joke, I've stumped the panel. Believe it or not, the word for potato in Hawaiian is wala kahiki, the last one, which, and I love this, it's also a slang term for a Hawaiian person who's trying to be white and kind of forsaking their own
culture. Oh, white on the inside, brown on the outside. Oh, is that the idea?
And yes, just for the
like
record.
Like an Oreo, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Melehune is a mushroom.
Who says there's not racism in Hawaii?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Melehune is mushroom.
I don't know who said that. I don't know. Did somebody say that?
What does lakika mean?
Kulina is corn, and lakika is a radish.
They're real words. I thought you made all of them up.
No, that would have been fun if I made them up. No, those are actual veggies.
He's just making up definitions.
No, that would have been racist if you made them up. Thank goodness you didn't. Yes. Okay.
True. I'm trying to make a poi joke. I can't think of anything.
Poi.
Anywho, we still have a 2-0 game with Leslie leading. And now, though, Robert Duback, you get to try and tie Leslie because this...
Let's go, Robert. Come on. I'm here for the visitors. Let's go.
Oh, and this is the time for...
Tell him most visitors get 0.
Yeah, I will say most... it. Yeah.
I heard. Don't you have to repeat it.
I didn't hear it.
But... Oh, she said most visitors get 0.
Oh, yes.
I'm actually trying to figure out how to score a negative...
No, that's Jeopardy. That's
oh, okay. That's right. I want to owe you guys money before this is over.
We do this for nothing. You understand? I mean, at least.
Oh,
Jeopardy,
that's not what he told
you.
Me. Oh, okay.
Now this is kind of interesting.
Promise you something.
This next is something we started 2 weeks ago, and I'm keeping going. So this question and a couple like it coming up are not tied to the date in history kind of thing. This is more like something closer to current events. And it's a word I'm going to give you. It's called 3 clues in the news. And I'm going to give you 3 words. And those words are connected in some way to, or make you think of the word that we're looking for that's in the news. So it could be the word blank, the word or word blank, or just a word that's like the word we're looking for. Okay. For example, where was my example? If I were to say sweet couch vegetable, the word would be?
Potato.
Bingo. That's the example. You don't get 2 points for that. The actual question
is, come on. Come on. Give a beginner some.
Dr. Sue. Hey.
I was just going to say that, but okay.
I need to do it.
So here we go. Are you ready?
Excuse me. Joyce should have a noise for the whenever anybody pulls a Dr. Sue. Is that a good one?
Here we go.
Okay.
Or that.
I like that. Dr. Sue, Robert, was a guest we had on the show, that they had on the show, that begged for points. It doesn't matter how she did it. She begged for points.
Really?
In a fun way.
She should have been more fun.
No,
she would have gotten more advances.
The way you did, dear. The way you did. Not offensively.
She can beg in Cuomo's office, I guess.
Yeah. Well, she
go back to the beginning.
Anywho.
Okay.
Are you ready for three clues in the news, Robert?
Yes.
You can never have Dr. Sue back on the show, David.
Well, I've invited her back, but she's been busy, honestly. When you guys have sometimes been away, you guys being David Sheward and Leslie Hoban.
She's a very nice lady.
Yeah, no, she's been great. And but the last time I invited her, she wasn't able to. So, but no, I'm totally.
Didn't her lawyer contact you?
Her union representative contacted me. Her parole officer.
That's her puppet.
All right, here we go.
Nice. We never said she wasn't nice. Just desperate. Oh.
Yeah.
Thirsty. Thirsty is the word. Yes.
Thirsty, yeah. Okay. Ready, Robert? Ready for?
Yes, I.
Long time ago. Here we go.
I think he dozed off, David.
Three clues in the news. The clues are high school, line, gathering.
What was this middle word?
High school, line, gathering.
David, is
remember, it isn't always blank something or something blank. It can also be.
Is it? No?
What?
Oh, man.
I actually enjoy watching the interaction as to how they're going to cheat or get their way. I have no. I high school line gathering. High school line gathering.
Yeah. Remember, those words are not connected to each other.
No, of course not. Of course, yeah, no.
Just promote your show. If you don't know an answer, promote your own. Yes.
Just say the book.
Yeah, my show, Barry, thanks very much. My show is called The Book of Moron. I have no idea what the answer is. So I'm my own moron. Come see The Book of Moron.
I'm my That's own moron. Everybody know the song.
Bring your teenage morons, even. Yes.
Okay, I'm gonna roll this die here, and the die comes up. Oh, it came up directly a boxcar number 6. So Leslie Hoban Blake, do you want to try?
It actually, I think, but it's not a single word. It was out on the island, or no, Staten Island. It was in Staten Island that there were a group of mothers who protested against mask wearing for their children. So you said, but you said high school.
High school?
No, this was not high school. Wait a minute. No, this was elementary school. I rescind everything I said. Whatever that was. I was so focused on that answer that I can't think of anything else now.
It's the Book of Moron. Line. It's the Book of Moron.
The Book of Moron. Okay. Do I get a pin that says I'm a moron too?
Yes.
Wasn't there a book called The March of the Morons or something? The Marching Morons?
Oh, I've heard of it. No.
Or how about Moron Becomes Electra?
No. No, there is something that has the word Marching Morons in it. I don't remember what it is. Anyway, let's go back.
It's that's just a parade school, to the GOP office. That's all.
Exactly. High school line, or what was the last one?
High school line gathering. So remember, it can be blank this or this blank, but also right. Can be a synonym.
And it is only one word. And it is only one word, because high school is two words.
I can say that it is just one word, yes.
Cocaine line.
No help from remember, the peanut gallery.
No help, okay.
No help from the peanut gallery. Let's just... Or am I dating myself again?
I remember high school cocaine, yeah.
Yes.
High school line gathering. No, I'll just say protest, but I don't know any. I can't imagine what it is.
Is that your? Oh.
It's my only answer because my mind is completely mashed now.
What?
I know. I said the magic word.
It triggers him.
I said the magic word, and the duck came down. Thank you.
Well, the lady doth protest too much because that is not the correct answer. So, David Sheward,
yes.
You can get on the board if you can guess this word.
This is tough. Okay, high school gathering line.
Right.
Now.
And also it's a word on some level that is connected to
I don't think it's chorus because that doesn't make any sense. And I don't think it's musical because... high school musical, line musical, high school maybe it's dance. Well, but what was in the news recently? High school.
Bunch?
I think I just got it.
It's too
late now. If David gets it wrong, I'll let you answer for no points. But yeah, yeah.
Line gathering. Gathering. What happened recently? Gathering.
You've been on vacation. You have no clue what's been going on.
I've been following the news, you know. I didn't go to the boondocks or whatever. vaccination? I don't know. Vaccination.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
Well, you took your best shot, Dave, but no, that is not the correct. So, Leslie, do you want to try? I mean, no.
I know no points, but I suddenly thought graduation.
High school graduation? No. Well, no, that is not okay. The correct answer. Oh, I stumped you on this, so I didn't know if I would. But here's the deal.
You love stumping us.
High school line gathering. The word we're looking for is assembly.
Oh, that's a bad one.
Why? High school assembly line.
Oh, yeah.
The gathering is, and it's, of course, the New York State Assembly that is looking to impeach.
Okay.
Assembly?
All right. Yeah. That's okay. I'll give you that.
What? Nobody
that
likes that.
That last clue was bad. Gathering assembly was weak.
Well, no, as I said, it's not always blank word or word blank. It's sometimes.
That's like setting up a joke that.
Yes, thank you.
Has a five removed or six.
This one was
separation to remove punchline to it.
I don't think the clues were good.
6 degrees of separation, yeah.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, you'll find another assembly blank or blank assembly. General.
Assembly, mass assembly?
Requires some.
What? Yeah. Yeah.
Mass.
You could just say requires. You didn't have to
requires.
Say some requires.
Yeah. I don't know if you're. If
mass assembly?
Yeah.
What?
What's mass assembly?
Something in church, something in Catholics.
Oh, mass, right. Well, yeah.
Gathering. Assembly gathering.
Yeah, a gathering is an assembly. It's a synonym. I said it's not always blank.
Oh.
I said good. Several That's times. So it's not always blank word or word blank. Yeah.
This is not good.
Gotta listen to the Dave. He's the host of the show.
Okay.
Anywho, but I will say.
I think you said assembling a toy.
Toy assembly. Yeah.
IKEA. You should have just said IKEA.
Assemble. Yeah. Right, okay. Anyway.
All right.
We're on to our second round of the Today Yesterday quiz.
Jeez, oh, is that all?
Yeah. It moves so slowly when you're having fun, right?
Yeah, we'll be here till 1 p.m. So, but Leslie is leading the game 2-0 so far. So we have our next round beginning, and it begins with David Sheward getting this question. It is yet another multiple choice. Here we go. 1885 was the year. To protect its interests in East Africa, Germany sent 5 warships to the coast of Zanzibar. Which of these famous folks was born in Zanzibar?
Oh, dear.
A. Freddie Mercury. B. Prela Kuti. C. Alicia Keys. Or D. Joan Armatrading.
Isn't it Armitage or something? Who's the second? What's the second one?
I'll read them all again. So, 1885, Germany sent warships to East Africa to Zanzibar. Yeah. Which of these famous folks was born in Zanzibar? A. Freddie Mercury. B. Fela Kuti. C. Alicia Keys. Or D. Joan Armitrading.
Who the hell is Felipe? Who's the second one?
Fela. Fela from the musical.
Fela. Oh, that person.
Oh. I'm sorry, I was mispronouncing Fela as Fela. Sorry.
Okay.
I guess it was a Fela on my part. Yeah.
I think he was born in Nigeria. I think that was that whole musical was in Nigeria, I think. But, you know, I think that's the obvious one because he's the only one that we think of as African.
That's racist.
No, African, as opposed to African American. Brett Summers. You know what? I'll go for the obvious, Fela.
Is that your...
Yeah, okay.
You don't even want to deal with it. Okay, well, even though you're a cutie, David Sheward, that is not, yeah, Fela cutie, not the correct answer. So we have a steal opportunity here. Oh boy. Let's see who gets the die going. Come on. We have a one. One is closest to Robert Dubac. Robert, you get to steal this question if you get it right. Which of the following was born in Zanzibar? Was it A, Freddie Mercury, C, Alicia Keys, or D, Joan Armatrading?
I'm going to pick Freddie Mercury just because it sounds so bizarre that I think it could be true.
You is that your
watch the movie, huh?
No.
Oh. Sorry, just...
The mercury too hot? Is it?
Yeah, the temperature's rising.
Are you projecting or assuming or presuming?
Well, I not only assume, I guarantee that you just earned yourself 2 points.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Robert Dubac. Yes.
Wow. All well, right, I'm right up behind you, Leslie. You know, buckle up, babe.
Yeah. Just be careful. Watch that language here.
Was that in the movie?
I have no idea.
No,
it was not in the movie. No. I forget what I said.
But Frank, he was apparently born in Zanzibar. Leslie, you were going to say. Sorry.
Oh, no, finish what you're saying. I'm sorry.
I was going to say that Fela, you were right, David Sheward. He was Nigerian. He was a Nigerian born. Alicia Keys was born in Hell's Kitchen, New York. And Joan Armatrading came from the West Indies. Oh. So there you go.
So all I was going to say is I believe, and I'd have to look it up, I believe the first name that came to my mind was Errol Flynn. I believe Errol Flynn was born in Zanzibar. Oh. I don't know
why I
think
he was born
in
Tasmania.
Thank you. That was it. One of those funny words was what I was thinking. Oh, terrible, terrible. Thank you. Thank you for clearing that up. I was going to have to run
Tasmanian devil.
Tasmaniac, you. Well, here's the deal, folks. We now have a tie game between Leslie and Robert Dubac. Yeah! But watch out for David. David. So,
do we know if Freddie Mercury's parents were like in the foreign ministry or something? We don't know.
No.
I have to Google.
They were, according to the movie, they were just ordinary people.
Oh, okay.
That he couldn't wait to get away from. So, you know.
So,
like everybody else, right?
Now we have Leslie, though. Leslie, you can build on your lead if you get this multiple choice question correct. The year 1934.
Woo!
On this date, the U.S. Court of Appeals.
August 8th or August 7th?
August 7th, I'm sorry. I know that's a big difference.
That would be the game would be over. Go ahead.
The U.S. Court of Appeals upholds a lower court's ruling that James Joyce's Ulysses should not be banned for obscenity. Which of these is not a chapter title of this complicated novel?
Wait, I got to run get it. No.
A, Oxen of the Sun, B, Ithaca, C, Penelope, D, Athena.
Well, it's based on the Iliad, so.
Who are you calling an Iliad?
No, moron. That's a moron.
It's not an idiot.
That's
it's
an oxymoron.
No. Book of Moron, playing from August 12th through October 3rd at the Soho Playhouse. Get your tickets at robertdubac.com.
Not an Iliad, it's a moron. October 3rd. Yes.
An oxymoron.
The first one you said, Oxen of the Sun. I'm going back here, guys. Oxen of the Sun, Penelope, Athena. What was the one I'm missing?
Ithaca, Penelope, Athena, Oxen of the Sun.
An oxymoron will clean your clothes.
That's true. Oxyclean.
It's a detergent for idiots.
Detergent for cows. Yeah, right. Against oxymoron. Okay. Yeah.
All right, everybody be quiet. I need to think. My brain does not function well. It's old. I'm going to go for the wrong answer, I think. The three that sound right, of course, are Ithaca, Penelope, and Athena. this, you want the one that is not.
That is right? Not a chapter title of Ulysses by James.
I'm going to say Oxen of the Sun.
Is that your final answer?
It's a pure guess, yes.
Well, I know you tried really, really hard to get that one right, but no, that is not the correct. Oxen of the Sun is, in fact, a title in Ulysses. So we're going to roll a die, and let's see who comes up with a, hello, let's do it, thank you, comes up number four, which is David Sheward's number. Okay. So, which of these is not a chapter?
Ithaca, in Penelope, or Athena?
Correct.
All right, now I'm pretty sure it's based on the Odyssey, not the Iliad.
Thank you.
And I tried to read it when I was in high school and I didn't finish it.
Me too.
But let's see. All of those sound plausible because it's based on the Odyssey and Penelope is Ulysses' wife, who would be Molly Bloom. So I think that is a chapter. So it's either Ithaca or Athena. And I think, I don't know. I mean, it could be either one of them. Ithaca.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
Yes, again. No, again. Yes, again. No, again. No, again. That is not the correct answer, I'm afraid. So, but Robert Duback, you can chuckle, but you can steal this question. You got a 50-50 shot at it. So we know it's not Oxen of the Sun. We know it's not Ithaca. One of these is not a title chapter in Ulysses. Is it Penelope or Athena?
Well, Dave, you say Penelope was the wife, but would they have, back in that day and age, dedicated an entire chapter to the wife? And Athena was a
goddess.
Athena was a goddess. I'm going to say Penelope is what was not a chapter, just so that we can all be wrong.
So that is your final answer?
Yes, it is my final answer.
Well, penny for your thoughts, but they're not worth a penny. That is okay. Not. It was Athena.
Oh,
it's not a chapter.
Okay.
I want to do a plug.
So important, Ulysses.
I want to do a plug. 100 years ago, in my very early directing days, I was able to direct a play by Sheila Walsh called Molly and James, which is constantly being done. It's a one-act play. And our original version is one of the very few one-act plays on tape at Lincoln Center.
Because
and I can't think of her name, David, you'll remind me, the lovely woman who started that.
Oh, Mary something?
No.
How do you remember?
Betty Corwin.
Thank you. Betty Corwin was kind enough, was a kind of a quasi-acquaintance and was kind enough to come and fell in love with what we did. And so we have a scratch tape at Lincoln Center of this play called James by Sheila Walsh, directed by moi, filmed by my son. And they took that as a scratch tape, but I can't be prouder of anything else. And it's a great little play. And here's the theme. James Joyce follows this woman around Dublin because she is so luscious and juicy, and he wants to make a character, and he decides to make it based on this woman who happens to be Molly Bloom.
Oh.
And he hides under her bed in her boudoir, and she talks to herself. None of what she says is in Ulysses or any other James Joyce, but it sure as hell sounds like it, because the Joyce people came after Sheila and said, you're not allowed to use anything. She said, show me anything I used except the word yes, which was the last word of the play, which is the first word of Molly Bloom's long monologue. David was never able to finish the book. Never able to finish.
I think, Joyce, you've read Ulysses, right? My wife has. She's smart.
My favorite James Joyce is Portrait of the Artist.
That was easier.
I was able to finish it.
But
it's also a lot about love. It's got a lot of love.
But did you finish Ulysses? I think you did. Or
I can't remember. Because I read the Russians. You know, I like the Russians.
Right.
Ulysses is like a Russian.
Well, I tried Russian.
Robert, where do you stand on Ulysses?
Where do I? I could never get through it either when I was younger. I Again, it's the Book of Moron.
Yeah. First sentence of Finnegan's Wake, I'm out. Yeah. The Clancy Brothers song is enough for me.
I also love The Dead, which is only
I got through.
Well, yes,
I love The Dead.
I got through most of Finnegan's Wake, but I didn't finish that either.
Wait, how did you get through Finnegan's freaking Wake? How the hell did you make it through that one?
I thought of it as poetry, and you know, tried to get through it.
Did it make any sense?
It was Adam and Eve, the creation, man and woman, life, you know.
Okay.
As they said at the beginning.
That shit, yeah.
That's why I watch Rocking Bullwinkle. I get all that there. I mean, it's basically the same thing.
Did the two Davids, did you ever go see a play called Himself, a musical about Joyce and Nora? It was downtown at the Minetta Lane.
No.
Maybe I did.
Sheila wrote that, the original book for that, and it was her play.
I have a vague recollection of seeing a James Joyce musical.
I went down to Florida to see that open, but the guy who did the music bought the script from her and then totally changed it. Oh. So,
is that an oxymoron, James Joyce musical?
Did you know there was another musical called The Dead? It was very good, actually.
I remember too.
Sheila had the most wonderful opening of any play in the original play. I did the reading of it in the original play. And she had, it's a coffin and it's awake, right?
Oh, I remember that. Yes, I think that was in the musical.
Yeah, but maybe they put that scene back, but it was somebody poured liquor into the coffin and James gets out of it.
I don't remember that at all. No.
To me was the best opening because that, you know, made it accessible. And that was the opening that nobody used. That never got done. Even in the production that she had, never got done.
Now, forgive me for making an assumption. I don't know if any of you is old enough, but I'm going to. Did anybody see Zero Mostel and Ulysses in Nighttown?
No, I wish I had. That's something I really wanted to see. Yeah. And there was no Betty Corwin tape thing at that point. It predates her.
Right. Anyway, we have our next question.
Are we still playing?
Yeah, there's a game here somewhere. To take us through the end of our third round, we have a question, though, that will go to Robert Duback, who can, in fact, build on your, you have a tie with Leslie, but you can take the lead if we have, how did you get this? Wow, you get another clue in the news. I know how I did that. I screwed up this way, but you get a clue in the news, Robert. So here we go. Now you know how it works, right?
Okay.
Three clues in the news. It's connected to some current event. So it can be blank or that blank or just a word that's sort of like it. Here are the words. Slave. Hard. Pains.
Oh, I know what this is.
Speak up. Speak up. Speak up.
Moron.
Don't kill me, Robert. You'll kill me.
Moron.
Book of Moron. Playing from Moron. October 1st.
Slave, pains, and...
Hard.
Hard. Work. Hard work. Pains. Slave. It's nothing more boring than watching someone think.
I don't know about that.
Okay. This is the only way I can, while I think, let me try to entertain you.
No! That's like the greatest thing I've ever seen. Thank you for that. You'll see.
I can do the other side too.
No.
Slave.
Oh, Lord in heaven.
Gosh. Pain. I'm gonna have to defer. I guess slave.
Defer. I need my fur. No, it's a very different thing, Potato. Take a guess.
Take it. Work.
Work.
Hard work. Slave. No. Yep.
Final answer.
Final answer. Got nothing.
I'm afraid that answer did not work for you,
yes.
Robert Duback. So we have a steal opportunity here. So we could wind up with a tie game, maybe, or with Leslie in the lead. Let's see. We got the number 6, which goes directly to Leslie Hoban Blake. Leslie.
Robert, you were so close. see, these clues work the way they're supposed to. The word is labor. The word is labor. Am I right? Labor, pain. These words are connected the way they've been in the past. That's why this would work.
Oh, I get it. I get it.
Slave labor, yeah. Hard labor, labor pains. So they work the way they're supposed to, Leslie.
Please don't ever work that way again. Thank you very much. Okay.
But Leslie, you get 2 points for stealing that question. And at the end of the second round, you're in the lead with 4 points, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, this program is brought to you by me. Labor. Well, sorry? What labor pains.
With labor.
Labor.
Labor pains. Slave labor.
What within the news?
It's something, it's women's
things. I'm sorry. Oh, the news item is that AFL-CIO leader Richard Trumka died a day ago. He's the head.
I didn't know anything about that.
Wait a minute. How does that
together?
Labor.
Oh, the labor.
He was the labor leader of the AFL-CIO.
Yeah, but I didn't pay attention to that.
Yeah.
No.
They're tricky. So, going into the third round of the today,
I think obscure is a little more definitive than tricky.
The obscure.
Fine. Well, I am Jewish, so I'm Jew the obscure. Hardy, har, har.
I'm dishing these puns out to you, Dave. I'm just laying them out there for you.
Robert, you're the first person to at least keep up with him. So, you know, we gave up or we don't try anymore.
Oh, thank you, buddy.
Thank you. Oh, Dave is saying, by the way, Robert, is when either of us will make a terrible, terrible pun, if it's bad enough, David Stewart will chime in with, "Oh, Mr. Peabody from Peabody and Sherman." So we begin our third round of this Today History quiz here on Dave's Gone By the way, I should mention it's August. Yeah, we're still in August 7th. 2021 with the 810th episode. We're calling it Back Atcha for Robert Duback.
I just want you to know, I gotta get on stage by Thursday. My show is at 9. All right?
That reminds me of when I went a couple years ago. We went, this is sort of an inside joke. Julie Halston, who was the recipient of a Tony Award this year, came, and Charles Bush were presented the Outer Critics Circle Awards. And they came and said, "Oh, hi, how are you? It's so nice to see you." "Yeah, we just got back from the Drama Desk Awards."
Oh, ouch.
Because that was the year that we had, like, 7 hours.
4 hours.
Seven hours. Yeah.
I remember they used to, and by the way, not to brag, but both Julie Halston and Charles Bush are friends of the neighborhood. They've been on this program. So you're in good company, Robert, David, and Leslie, playing the game.
Charles Bush was once a cottage industry for me. I think I interviewed him 5 times in about 6 years. Wow. Well, he was always doing something new, and it worked out, you know. Back when I was in print. This was back in those days.
At this point, Bush should really be a tree. He's done so much, I think,
a monument, excuse me, a monument.
Let us begin round 3 of the Today Yesterday quiz, which will start with a question for David Sheward. Time for you to get on the board, David. Okay. Which you can.
David, you can get a goose egg.
Non-multiple choice question. This is just a plain old.
Q&A. Okay, go ahead. I'm ready.
1970 was the year. Joining the band Fleetwood Mac today is this singer-songwriter who was an art college graduate and former singer for the band Chicken Shack. Name that tunesmith.
It would be a rock music question or a pop rock.
This is why we roll the die to see who goes when, but yeah.
Not my category. Stevie Nicks.
Is that your...
Final answer. Okay. Yeah, sure.
Well, just in the nick of time, you got that wrong, I'm afraid. No. So that is not the correct answer. We're going to roll some die here. We're going to cast that die among the waters, and we come up with a number 3, which is Robert Duback's direct number. Robert, I'll ask the question again. 1970 was the year. Joining the band Fleetwood Mac today is a singer-songwriter who was an art college graduate and former singer for the band Chicken Shack. Name that tunesmith.
Chicken Shack?
The one who joined or the one who dropped out?
Joining, 1970 was the year. Joining the band Fleetwood Mac today.
Well, I'm going to give you 2 names, and then I'm going to choose one, and then Leslie, if I'm wrong, you pick the second one, okay?
Merci beaucoup.
It's either Lindsay Buckingham or it's Bob Welch. But I think Bob Welch ended up leaving the band before they became famous, but I don't know if they were famous in 1970. So I'm going to say Bob Welch. I think.
Well,
Welch,
I'm afraid you have to Welch out on that deal. That is not the correct answer. Leslie Hoban Blake.
Robert, thank you. I knew it was Lindsay, but I think it's Lindsay Buckingham. But they just did a thing on Fleetwood Mac on PBS, which is a tribute to Robert Welch.
Yes.
It was a tribute to his time in the band and all the stuff that he did.
Biggest mistake anybody made joining a band and quitting. He quit right before they hit their big platinum sell.
But they were kind enough to actually honor him, which
well,
I
that's
thought
nice.
Was something.
Oh, great.
The Beatles never honored Stephen Best or anybody, you know.
Not the drummer.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
True. All right, so we're going to share this. These
sure,
two points.
Share,
one goes to Leslie, one goes to me. If
I'll
we're
share,
right.
Well, yeah, we're still tied. It doesn't matter to me.
Well, so Leslie, what's your answer though?
Lindsay Buckingham.
Well, Leslie, you tried to buck the system, but that's not the correct answer.
Oh no!
Oh fuck! Then it's Christy McVie, I think probably.
Better than
okay. I'm sorry.
Sorry. No. Oh, that's.
She was the legendary Christine Perfect, and then in 1969 she married John McVie, and then Christine McVie, and in 1970 she joined Fleetwood Mac after singing with Ram Chicken Shack. What?
What was their first?
Oh, we shared the nothing there, Robert.
Well, Fleetwood Mac.
They were around so long that they had sort of minor hits with blues based rock and pop. Long before, I mean, even Welch had a kind of a hit song. He did Sentimental Lady with them before that first Fleetwood Mac album hit, and then Rumors came on.
Well, Welch left before everybody married everybody else, too. Yeah.
So, who was that guy? The guy who just died, their original, bass player. He died a couple of weeks ago.
And that's what I want on my tombstone, what you said. Who was that guy who just died?
I know.
I just want to put that right on my...
What was his name? He was... Peter Green, I think it was.
Oh, no, that's the one they did the salute to. I'm sorry, it wasn't Robert Welch. It was that guy.
It was Peter Green.
Oh,
yeah, he was
Peter Green. They
know what Dorothy Parker, I think what Dorothy Parker said.
Eat my dust, or what is it?
If you can read this, you're standing too close.
Yes.
Right. I like that. All right,
if you remember the 70s, you weren't there. Yes, right.
Now, Leslie, you do pretty well usually with these three clues in the news's thingies.
She does. So
this three clue in the new... goes to you.
It's the New Zoo Review. Come and write you.
Everybody remember the New Zoo Review?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Unfortunately, yes.
It's the awful show.
So here's Leslie, you already have the lead. You can really.
No way to kill it. No way to kill me from getting it, but that. Go ahead.
Remember, these are words that are related, could be blank this, blank that. Or this blank and so forth.
You better give me the right clue.
Relate it to the news. Okay. Here are your clues. Teen gum.
Thank you for the silence, guys. I appreciate it. I am totally not getting anything. I get a different clue for each word.
David is content. He's already got it figured out.
I think I've got it.
I'm going to say, and it's got nothing to do with your clues, I'm going to say the Olympics, but I don't think that has anything to do with the clues.
But is
Olympics. Yeah, I'm going to give you the, I don't know.
Well, even though you're always a good sport, Leslie, it is not the Olympics. So we get to, let's see, does David get on the board if he, let's see, we got a one. I rolled a one, which means that he's closest to Robert Duback.
Yeah.
Robert, can you?
You can win this, Robert. This
I
will
could.
Be it for you.
I could.
Well, this is
but
it.
I just, is this the last question?
No,
this
one.
Or the game?
There's one more question after this.
After this?
Yeah, but it doesn't count.
Robert
unless,
gets it.
No, no, no.
Unless we're still tied. No, are you, okay.
Oh, Leslie gets it, Leslie.
Yeah.
Oh, no, Robert gets it.
Robert gets Robert the gets question, it. But we haven't done this one yet. And then we
team,
have
a team gum, team, and teen, and gum.
Team, teen, and gum. Relate it to something in the news.
Yeah.
I take it that means Joyce knows what it is.
You got it.
Yeah, I think so.
They're always good when you figure them out. When you can't.
Oh, like yeah, of course.
Stupid it's, question.
This is like, I got that word on the tip of my tongue. What is it? What is it? It just doesn't come. Rapper? Team? A rapper? Team rapper? Rapper? Some hip-hop... go ahead. That's my final.
I know you wanted to wrap it up and take it home, but that is not the correct answer. So, David Sheward, you were nodding.
I think I know what it is. I'm going to say spirit.
Is that your final answer?
Yes.
Gum, spirit.
Yeah, that makes
sense. Spirit, gum.
You got it. Yeah, right.
Chewing gum. Yes.
Smells like team spirit, of course.
You got
and
it.
Spirit gum. Spirit
absolutely.
And in the news because?
The Olympics?
Oh, no. Spirit Airlines has had such hard, they've canceled like all their flights this week.
Oh.
Can you take a half a point away? Wait, can you take a half a point away?
Thank you, negative Dr. Chu.
Yes.
The negative, in reverse.
That's the, yeah.
In reverse.
Not only
I have to say that Joyce's cackle from the couch is the noise we need. That was great.
Not only is she a negative Dr. Sue would be not someone who tries to get points for herself, but tries to take points.
Take it away from somebody else. Right.
So here's the deal. This is very interesting now because we have one more question to end round three. The game is Leslie with 4 points, David and Robert both on with 2. So this question could mean a lot could happen with this question.
Yeah.
It means we could be here till tomorrow.
The fate of the Western world.
He said it that way. Didn't he say it like, this is really important.
Yeah.
He had a really important voice going.
Here's the deal. Robert, this question goes directly to you. If you get it right, okay, you will tie Leslie and the tiebreaker will actually mean something. If you get it wrong, though, Leslie could steal and win outright. David could steal and tie her. It could go all different ways. So here's the I'm excited about this.
Just remember, everything depends on this.
Yes.
The success of your show, yeah. Book of Moron at the...
yeah, great. Any good reviews are all going to depend on this answer to this question.
David Sheward, are we playing some weird alternate universe game of hump the host here?
I would hope not.
No, I'm sorry, that was sexually offensive. I take that back.
Yeah. Oh, that's quiet.
Let's get the guess.
Well, I'll be. Okay, here we go. So, Robert, the year is 1977. On this, and this is interesting how it could have gone to David or Leslie, but it went to you. 1977 was the year. On this date, August 7th, the musical Shenandoah closes after 1,050 performances at Broadway's Alvin Theater. Speaking of Alvin, which of these pop songs has not been officially covered by Alvin and the Chipmunks? Is it A, Whip It, B, Ice Ice Alvin, C, Betty Davis Eyes, or D, Rock the Casbah?
Which one did the chipmunks? All three chipmunks or just Alvin?
Oh.
And Theodore and were they and hired Simon, out as a background for another?
As show? The trio, occasionally joined by Lin-Manuel Noriega.
No, I think they broke up, David. The chipmunks are broke
before
up.
They broke up.
Yeah. So Bob Welch was part of this group.
True. Well, his name was Bob Perfect, and before he changed it and married. Yeah. So here's the deal.
One
of these has not been officially recorded by Alvin and the Chipmunks. Is it A, Whip It, B, Ice Ice Alvin, C, Betty Davis Eyes, or D, Rock the Casbah.
They're all good. That's a good.
They are. They would be great songs for the entire chipmunk community to perform.
Especially if they wanted to score some beaver. But yeah, really? Okay.
No.
It's an animal show, isn't it? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, see, right. It's that was pelt very well.
Thank you.
I will say, let's see. It just sounds like they should have done Whip It, and I can't remember them ever doing it. So I'm going to whip it. Whip It.
Is that your final answer?
Yes, it is. Are you going to get that thing in tune before we leave?
We're waiting for the piano tuner to come.
Okay. Or just break it.
Piano salmon. Okay, I don't even know what that means. So, although we want to go forward and move ahead, Whip It is not the correct answer. In fact, Alvin and the did
Whip It? Okay.
No, I remember I have to understand that.
Have to go through my CDs and my cassette tapes just to re-listen to those chipmunks.
I should be fair and understand that it's not like the original 1960s. They've continued. They have a movie out there, movies. Over the years,
so
they've continued. So they have done this kind of music. But now we have a steal opportunity.
Yeah, didn't they just cover, they covered Lady Gaga's Bathroom?
And so they probably have. That's the thing. So let's do a die roll for coming up the number two, which is Robert Duback directly, but you just didn't get that.
Oh, give me another shot.
No, but two is close two is closer than to David Sheward. So David.
Closer to David Sheward, yeah. I was going to tell you that.
So what are my choices?
Your choices are, again, which of these has not been covered by Alvin and the Chipmunks?
If you asked the Bugs Bunny question, he would know it.
There you go. Is it D, Ice Ice Alvin, C, Betty Davis Eyes, or D, Rock the Casbah?
David, your sound has gone down.
Oh,
fix your sound.
There you go.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, David.
Yeah. I didn't do anything differently. I don't know why that happened. Anyway, I think Ice Ice Alvin, it wouldn't be called that if it weren't a cover. It would just be Ice Ice Baby, which is the Vanilla Ice thing. But that may be a trick. But so I'm going to eliminate Ice Ice Alvin. So that leaves Rock the Casbah and Betty Davis Eyes. And I have a vague memory of Alvin, of those high-pitched, speeded-up voices, seeing Betty Davis Eyes. So I'm going to say Rock the Casbah.
Final answer?
Yes. Yeah.
David Sheward, you rock. Somehow you got that right. That is the correct answer. They have not, to my knowledge, or to recorded knowledge. Because it's a little weird if you check on YouTube, like every song ever, somebody's done in an Alvin and the Chipmunks way. But officially, the Chipmunks did do Ice Ice Alvin, Betty Davis Eyes. They have not done the date The Clash's Rock the Casbah. David Sheward, you get 2 points. David Sheward, you are tied.
Finally.
With Leslie Hoban Blake.
All right.
Well, the lead after three rounds, which means the tiebreaker is meaningful. So what we could wind up with is either a three-way tie or a winner amongst our panelists. So are you guys ready to go into, let me explain how the tiebreaker works.
Is this the first time the tiebreaker actually had meaning? I think it is.
I think a week ago, last week we...
Out of 810 shows?
Well, we haven't been doing this segment for... This has only been going on for barely a year. I think we've been doing
it. We started during the pandemic, I remember. It was a reason to get out of bed.
Yeah, there you go.
It really was. Very grateful, David. I had no reason to get out of bed for a long time.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you, Leslie. So here's the deal. Everybody's going to play the tiebreaker quiz, but we do it a little differently. This is why at the very beginning, I asked you to get a pen and a piece of paper. Because for the tiebreaker, I ask the question, you write your answer down. Then I'll read the question one more time, and I'll give a 3-2-1 countdown. And when I say 3-2-1, you all hold your answers up to the camera so you can
like
all...
Like this, Robert. That was last week's answer.
Yeah, okay. Which you got right, by the way. So, are you all ready?
Yes.
For a tiebreaker question? Yes. Right. A straightforward trivia question. August 7th, 1912. The Bull Moose Party, founded by this politician, nominated him for president, but he didn't win. Name him.
They nominated him for president. David, okay.
Is this actually between David and me?
Well, actually, it could be all three of you, but you're all playing. But David and you are tied.
Right.
Robert is 2 points.
If we both get the right answer, just out of curiosity, because I don't think this has happened, what would happen then? We'd have to do another one?
You actually fight to the death.
That's when we oil up and get in the cage. Okay.
We all
I
actually
knew there
asked.
Was an oil up get in the cage
Wait,
thing. Right?
I've got two. Leslie has two.
No, David.
So you have four. You have four. Leslie.
You both have four. Don't
we
you?
We both have four.
I have two. That's all I
have
got.
Two. So well, Robert.
Well, excuse me. I meant Robert has four. Right?
Oh, it's Robert and me that I'm fighting. I didn't know
sorry.
I was.
Who's winning?
We just got David out of zero land. Okay,
yeah.
I got
I'm very,
it.
Sorry. David Stewart has two.
I have
Robert
two.
Has four. Leslie has four. So it's
so it's you and me, Robert. Okay.
Or it could be a three-way tie. That's I'm afraid.
Okay, both, okay, got
the
it.
The problem is, David, I think of you as a letter D, but Duvac is D, so I'm getting a little confused.
He's trying to get out of it, but, you know, don't let him.
Okay.
Here we go.
I'm ready.
Either way, we're going to figure out the point total by seeing your answers to this question, the year 1912, the Bull Moose Party, founded by this politician, nominated him for president, but he didn't win. 3, 2, 1. 1, 2. Oh my gosh. Oh my goodness. Look at this. First of all, bravo. Three-way bravo. So everybody gets 2 points.
That's what you said last night. Get it?
Oh.
Wait, show that again, Robert. Did you have something on the side?
Oh,
there
I was doing some free advertising here.
I know that, but what was on the bottom there?
I had
so
Bob Welch written
tie.
Over here, too, because I was taking
Yes, I got
notes,
it. I got it.
Well, it's a two-way. Okay. The finale, we actually end with a tie. The tie is between Robert Duvac, first timer, my goodness, and Leslie Hoban.
Robert.
With David Sheward very
Thank
close
you.
Behind with 4 points. What a game!
So what do we do now?
I'll give you free tickets. I'll give you free tickets.
I have the
show.
Right answer too.
Oh.
Hang on, wait a minute.
Wait, you're not okay with a tie?
You don't have another question?
No, that was a tiebreaker. If there's no tie, there's a tie. Do you need me to come up with a question?
Well, we never played it this way, so I didn't know that. It never happened while I've been playing.
I know. It never happened.
I promise I'll never play again. I don't want to do
that. No, I want you to come back.
I have a question. I have a trivia question for just such emergencies, and I can offer it to
Oh,
the
good.
Team.
And
sure.
then if we don't,
Go
if
ahead.
We don't answer correctly,
it doesn't
then
matter.
Your question
we don't
wins.
Get it right. Go ahead,
so then
David.
We'll all be tied again, and we'll have to do it.
Here's
go ahead,
the question.
David. Shoot.
And are they supposed to write it down?
How do you want to play it? You take over. I mean, they can write down. Write down on the opposite side.
Write down on the other side of the sheet what you can do. This is. I admit. Okay. Here's the question. All right. What Emmy-winning actress played three different guest starring roles in the original Star Trek?
Is he talking Kirk Spock?
Yes, the original the original
during the Spock era.
Yes. What Emmy-winning actress played three different guest starring roles on the original Star Trek?
I should know this. I watched those.
Then Commander Kirk. Leslie, you got it. It's yours.
I watched it several times. This is what I was trying to say. The series, when I was on the road, it used to play three times in various parts of Pennsylvania when I was working. But I can't think of anybody who ever won an Emmy. That's the problem. Someone who went on to win an Emmy, because it sure wasn't from that.
She did not win an Emmy for Star Trek. She went on.
I know. She went on to win an Emmy, obviously. But
was
I can't
it Christine
think
McPhee?
That.
I don't know.
That was Phyllis Diller.
This is a guess. I'll say Elizabeth Montgomery, but it's a pure guess. I don't know.
How about, well, do you want to guess? Because I don't know. I have no idea.
No, I have
maybe
no
can
idea.
Do initials.
No, Robert said he didn't have any.
I have no idea. I've got no.
Can you do the initials, David? Would that be
initials? The initials are BB.
Betty Davis?
BB as in Victor?
No, BB.
BB.
Two B.
Betty Buckley?
No.
No.
I'm just.
It is kind of obscure, I admit.
Oh, okay.
I thought maybe I do know this one, but I'm going to give the because
there's no point.
Now, it was an actress, and it's still the same gender. I mean, if we want to be politically correct here.
It was not someone who.
David, was there an act? Was it Barbara Bates? Am I making that actress up? Barbara.
There was a Barbara Bates, but it wasn't
Barbara Bain.
And it wasn't Barbara Bain.
Oh, then I'm wrong. That's what I thought it was.
Was it Bill Bixby?
No. Gary Bonds?
Get that before the operation. Get her on the show.
Alice Cosgrove. Does anybody remember that joke? That was the one about Alice Cosgrove. Never mind. It's too old.
Okay, the answer is Barbara Babcock.
Oh, from Hill Street, right.
Who could forget Barbara Babcock? From me. I could forget her completely. Okay.
That was a good one.
And
so, David, do you have another question? Because we're still tied.
Oh, all right. Let me think a minute.
This is a great idea.
Robert, this yes. is hell. Yes, you discovered what hell is.
I'm sure. I'm glad that during COVID, I'm glad that during COVID, I wrote an entire show.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise, I would have been stuck.
Right. Go ahead.
Let me think a minute.
Robert's written a fifth show while he's been on.
Yeah, we've got a new show. Let's
see. Okay, a new one.
He's written a.
Oh, okay.
A
what? Yeah, I'm going to play all four characters.
He's giving it clue. Yes. Go ahead.
What Wagnerian opera does Bugs Bunny quote when Elmer Fudd is singing a love song to him in What's Opera, Doc?
Oh my lord! Esoteric, much, David.
Yeah.
You need to know the name of the music, the piece of music.
No, of the opera.
The opera.
The opera name. The opera name.
The opera.
Your dad would know this, David, if he was here. He likes the Bugs Bunny.
Ready?
It's got to be something by Wagner, right?
I'm guessing, totally guessing. It's only fair if I play two.
Okay.
All right.
We'll give a 3-2-1.
Say when it's
all I got. That's all I got. That's all I got.
Are you against me?
I have tricked.
It was Tannhäuser.
Really?
Yeah.
That's funny. You mentioned Tannhäuser?
Well, retoin, my love. I want you always beside me. That's from Tannhäuser.
That's from Tannhäuser. All right.
What was
wrong? I was going to go for Valkyries. But that's not the right one.
Yeah. Here's a pun for you, David. What was Elmer Fudd's religion?
What was
Judaism? I don't know.
I was a Wesbitalian.
Oh, Mr. Peabody.
Oh.
And see.
Okay. And by the way, the end of that scene, I think, is Leslie winning the game. You had Tannhäuser, right? How did you know that? Wow. Well done.
Don't ask. Pulled it out of my somewhere.
So now we have a way. I guess we need to think of a way if tiebreakers don't break ties.
What happened, David?
The loser gets to ask questions.
To be someone like David Sheward, who has this incredible encyclopedia of crazy things in his head. Yes.
Leslie won last week, and Leslie is now the crowning champion. Yay. 2 weeks in a row.
So now, David, the wait. Now we really have a bout next week, right?
Let's all credit to Robert Duback, who did as well about
as incredible, Robert.
Ever.
Well, thank you.
Very, very good.
Have on the program. Did you know thanks he has a one-man show that he's doing? I don't know if you heard about this.
No, I haven't heard.
The Book of Moron. It's at the
Soho. What a clever title. I wonder where you got that from.
You know what's interesting about that title? I had it way even before the Book of Mormon was done. I was working with the title. And I got a letter from Rudin saying that he would sue me. And now that Rudin's gone... I have no.
Wait, is that really true? Scott Rudin threatened to sue you over that.
Yeah, he actually sued. There was a gal, I forget her name, but she did a one woman kind of a cabaret called The Book of Merman, where she did all Ethel Merman songs.
I saw that.
He got her to stop that too.
He cut her out. That's terrible.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course. Although I was hoping, I could use it for publicity. So
I sexually harassed Scott Rudin.
I assume he didn't like your.
He was sitting in the seat that I was assigned in that special front row in the middle of Signature. You know, that has a lot of room, and I need to put my left leg up because I have a problem. So there's this guy sitting there, and he looks exactly like the guy who runs the working theater, Larry Hirshhorn. To me, in my mind, I think it's Larry Hirshhorn. So I walk over to the guy who looks like Larry Hirshhorn, and I put my fingers on his knee because I know him very well. And I go, Larry, without saying his name, I said, would you let me take that seat? Because it's the one on my ticket, and you can have the one next to me. It wouldn't have made any difference. I could have taken the empty seat. And he looks up and he goes, and he's smiling and he's a little perplexed. And my finger's on his knee. And he goes, sure. And he moves over. And I take the seat, which is now warm. And at the intermission, I look over and I go, that's not Larry Hirshhorn. Fuck, that's Scott Rudin. So I go, I'm so sorry. I thought you were somebody else when I, he said, no, no, it's perfectly fine. I said, in that case, can I send a play to your office? And he said, yes. He never answered. He never responded. He never did anything. But I think he thought it was part of a bit. It wasn't. I honestly thought he was somebody else. But I actually touched
that's,
the knee.
That's actually the biggest sin is to think he's somebody else. I'm surprised. I know. You didn't catch for that.
Nice to hear a nice story about Scott Rudin, because God knows there aren't many
the nice thing is he warmed my seat for me. Thank you very much.
He's a rather capacious man.
That's rather personal.
We'll go back to earlier in this whole show and use that word oily instead of warming that seat for you. And I think that'll be a little more appropriate.
It's not oily anymore. It's 20 to 12 Eastern time here in the neighborhood. And we've had an absolutely delightful fun time playing the Today Yesterday quiz with our wonderful panelists. Let's first of all thank our near almost champion. I mean, he made it all the way through the tie. Essentially, it was a tie until we figured out that Leslie is the winner this week. But boy, oh boy, Robert Duback, you did terrific.
Well, thanks very much.
And if you want to see something terrific, go see the Book of Moron. It's going to be playing at the Soho Playhouse starting August 12th, a couple of days away, all the way through October 3rd. October 3rd. If you are a frontline worker, for the first weeks of previews.
There's six previews, and they all get it. We've got to set aside a bunch of tickets for frontline workers for free, so they can come.
Who is your press rep?
Keith Sherman.
I think I got something already. That's why I knew about the show. He's doing his job. Okay. I just want you to know.
Yes, certainly is. It was. I went through Keith and Scott in that office to get Robert Duback on the show. So thank them also. Do teachers count as frontline workers?
Yes. We're not going to check. I'm the guy who's, it's a one man show. So I'm going to be handing the tickets and I'll be seating people and I'll be.
Interestingly.
Yes. Yes, Dave.
Robert's show is, according to the press release, is directed by Gary Shandling. I didn't know that.
Oh, I totally forgot to ask the rabbi last question.
Well, Gary and I were best friends for years and later in his life, and it's still hard to get over. But he and I worked on the show. I've got this. I don't want to make light of it, but the first show, The Male Intellect, was directed by Blake Edwards. He had helped him with that. So while he was doing Victor Victoria here in New York, so he did that with me. And then he passed away. Gary and I worked on this show. And he passed away before I ever got it to New York. And so I write the new show that I'm writing. I'm thinking of getting Bill Maher to direct it. So that. there's your joke.
Any Gary Shandling story? I mean, because he was a brilliant, brilliant comedian.
Yes.
Rather strange human being, or at least that's the person.
Well, he was private. And the thing is that, but not only private, Gary had, I'm sure you're familiar with Roy London. All of you as far as a director and a teacher, but we all came from the Meisner school of acting. And so Gary was really instrumental in, which is why in our interview, David, earlier, what we were talking about,
Rabbi Sol.
Really, there's no good Republican comedians because they don't speak truth. It's all, kind of jokes and set up and things that aren't quite real. So, but Gary was always, we were always trying to decipher what's the real truth and the real essence of the joke so that it resonates and it makes more fun because it has more meaning to it. So, and that's why in my kind of shows, it's really all laughter within telling a story. I don't take little time sections aside where I get a little pathos and a little dramatic, nothing. It's all nonstop laughter, but within that music, there is some sort of meaning and gravitas to the
show. Can you give us I would love to know, like a specific example of a line or a section that he helped shape, or when he told, oh, you're bullshitting now, you know?
Yeah, geez. Well, I do a lot of characters in the shows, and like I just explained to you, in this show, Dave and Leslie, I'm in a coma and I have these five voices, like my ego and superego, but they're the common sense, voice of reason, inner moron, my inner child and my inner asshole. These are the five guys that populate the stage along with me. And the first one that shows up, and they all have very distinct voices. And the first one that shows up does his little, you know, two or three line response. And it's real funny. And Gary was one to say, he has a very southern redneck kind of drawl to him. And afterwards, even though it was funny, just kind of laid there, there was no explanation. And Gary says, you need to recognize that. And it's one of the funniest lines in the show where after I do it and I break out of character, I go back to myself and I say, I don't know why my common sense sounds like a redneck, but he is, he has common sense. And it's just it was always Gary's kind of gift to say, okay, I know what the audience is thinking and it needs to be told. It needs to be said.
Right.
I mean, if someone knew about breaking the fourth wall of comedy,
yes, fourth wall in these solo shows, at least the one that I do, they do have to break the fourth wall. For me to be successful at it, because the audience is really the other character in the show. It's, you know, it may be a solo show, but they're the ones, they just don't have any lines. They just laugh and react, and you have to react truthfully to them. And that's why people will ask me, aren't you tired of doing the same show over and over again? I find that every time I do it, it gets deeper and deeper and deeper into what I'm trying to, you know.
Well, I have to say, Robert, just as you go along doing it, if you ever need an understudy to play the inner asshole, please. I mean, you're looking at him. I'm available. I'm pretty good, you know, especially in that context. So
yeah. You can be in the wings. You can watch every night.
We'll bring you on. Oh my God.
In the show, there is a door of truth. I open it up and I can have the inner asshole walk out, the true inner asshole. And that will be you.
There you go.
Well, you could do a different one of us every show.
Sure. I'll have a guest. Yes.
A guest.
I'll have all the stars. Yes.
This week's celebrity guest asshole.
Yes.
That's right. Well, Bill Maher, or anybody you wanted, you know.
Well, we go back to Scott Rudin now, and we'll bring him on.
Okay,
but he may have to wear an ankle bracelet, so we might not be able to do that.
To get through the door.
Yeah, right. Ladies and gentlemen, we've had the delight of sharing with Robert Duback. Please go see his show, The Book of Moron, at the Soho Playhouse. Find out more. Get your tickets at robertduback.com, D-U-B-A-C, robertduback.com. Go see that. And Robert, just thank you very much for sharing with us all this whole program today. Leslie Hoban Blake, you look fantastic. I hope you feel fantastic.
Bless your heart.
And
I'm feeling well, thank you. Yeah, I'm doing fine. Great. End of story. I'm doing fine right now, yes.
Good to know. And thank you for being with us on this and so many episodes of Dave's Gone By. We hope to see you next week. And we can see you, even though you're not taping new ones at the moment. Remember that Critic Circle and Two on the Isle are both YouTube channels.
In perpetuity, evidently. I don't know. It's there forever. Well,
until YouTube goes away, it's there. You know, it's not like a website. If you don't renew it, it's gone. Right. Like, it's there. And David Sheward, I read somewhere you wrote a new blog this week about the Broadway season or something. What was it?
Well, I wrote a blog about, since we're waiting for the theaters to reopen, I started going, and there's this Facebook group called Broadway Remembered, in which people post their memories of shows since we're waiting for new shows. And I started just categorizing, I'm trying to remember all the, you know, different shows I've seen in almost 50 years or over 50 years of theater going. And I wrote different blog posts in different categories. Like, here are all the summer stock shows I remember seeing. Here are all the national tours. Here are all the pre-Broadway tryouts. Here are all the shows I ushered. And so that's what I've been doing lately, just posting memories and so forth.
And people can read those by going to either Cultural Week, Cultural Day, one of them, theaterdave.com. Wait, no.
Those are on the David desk.
Oh.
My reviews of and articles are on Cultural Daily and Theater Week.
No, Theater Life.
Theater Life, I'm sorry, yes.
I have to correct you on this now. Theater Life.
David's a tiebreaker.
Yeah.
David Sheward, you're over 50?
Yes.
Oh, she doesn't need no question about me.
David, I just had a birthday. We're not even talking, okay? But I'm saying you're over 50.
I am way over 50.
So am I at this point. God.
But
we all look great.
I met you when you were a baby. You and Joyce had just gotten together, I think, or maybe you hadn't even met Joyce yet. I don't even know.
Yeah, we were married. I was banging her, but we weren't married. No,
I don't think you were married when I first met you at the O'Neill.
No, I don't think
you were married. Okay.
We were just, yeah.
When we all went to Paris together, that was your honeymoon, I think, right?
Well, honeymoon was Hawaii, but we were pretty close to that time.
Really?
Yeah, I think we were. Not sure. Anyway, time to go on with the show. Here's the deal. Everybody, wave and goodbye because I have to let you go individually. But thank you so much, all of you. David, Robert, also come back and play when you have five hours. Come back.
Yes, I have one thing for you guys. For if you want to do a new tiebreaker, just have everybody bring their phone up and see how many calls they've missed during this marathon show, and whoever has the most wins the entire
you
game.
You probably win, right, Robert? Yeah. This is an automatic thing.
Nobody wants
to. Right?
Nothing at all.
Thanks very much.
I just missed a call from my friend Scam Likely. Yeah. Have a great one,
good
guys.
Scam. I love that guy. Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye,
everybody. Yeah, Thank you so much.
This is Scam. Call him. Call him back.